to help to coordinate and organize the substantive dialogue. And I'm going to say a few words about the process that we undertook, but also a little bit about the history. Because there are some new IGF initiatives, and there are some quite mature IGF initiatives in terms of the number of years that they've existed. When we walked out of Tunis with the text in hand called the Tunis Agenda, we had a paragraph which called on the UN Secretary General of the United Nations to convene a forum for the purposes of informal discussion in a non-binding, non-negotiating environment to examine and develop public policy issues related to the internet. We have a quite substantial agenda defined in paragraph 72 of the Tunis Agenda that defines the functions and purpose of the IGF itself. And we have a reference to the importance of the involvement at the national and regional level as well. We didn't have a roadmap for what the IGF itself was going to look like, and we were very privileged that the government of Greece offered to host the first IGF, which set a date and a goal, and we somehow managed to create a secretariat, which didn't exist before, and to hold the first IGF in Athens, Greece. Beginning in 2006, I began organizing half-day preparatory sessions in the United States to create awareness about what the IGF was so that there would be somebody from the United States who would attend the first IGF. That began to happen in many other countries as well. It happened in Europe, it happened in Africa, it happened in Latin America, but there was no such thing as a formal designation of a national or regional IGF. But out of those informal engagements, the bottom-up sort of organic growth of the national and regional IGFs has emerged. And we went from having none in 2006 because we had our first IGF to now having a very substantial number, which you're going to see, and great diversity in the national and regional IGFs. The purpose of this session, we began holding these substantive dialogues several years ago. They've taken many different flavors. We experimented with the idea of having two 90-minute sessions, making one substantive, one more about procedures. We've done a number of things. And what I would say is, I think we need to come back and revisit how we're going to maximize the interaction between the national and regional IGFs, both at the coordinator level and at the thematic level, but also think together about what our advice is as coordinators or individuals who are heavily involved as the chair of organizing a national initiative or a participant that's very heavily involved. What are the kinds of recommendations that we would make to the Secretariat and to the MAG and to the community at large about further support that will support the functioning of the present national and regional IGFs and help to grow more? So the agenda today was developed actually out of a consultative process, including coordinators' calls that some of you were able to attend. We have not had the kind of turnout into the coordinators' calls, and that's one of the things toward the end of the session we'll talk about are there better ways to continue to communicate across the coordinators. The second thing we did, we agreed to do a survey, and that survey tells us quite a bit about what is going on. So we're going to review the survey. Then in the survey, we identified the themes that the coordinators nominated to be addressed in this session. And interestingly enough, the themes that were chosen were the themes that were chosen were connecting the next billion and focusing on improving and increasing the interaction and reflection from the national regional IGFs into the IGF and from the IGF back into the national and regional IGFs. Our survey actually addressed that question, I think, quite substantially, and we're going to hear from the team leaders who did the analysis. The development of the survey was done with a survey development group and then a survey analysis teams that were drawn from volunteers. And I want to, at this point, give really special recognition to Anja Genko, who is our Secretariat Support, and I think need you to turn around and wave at these people so they recognize you. And the woman that just walked in the door, Serena, who supported me last year in working with the national and regional IGFs and so fell in love with the opportunity that she took special leave from her job this year and returned to work at the Secretariat to help at the IGF overall, but also to help us, and particularly has played a very large role in helping to analyze the survey results, working with Anja and also with Mark Buell. So at this point, I'd like to open the floor, first of all, to comments from, I'm going to give Yanis, our MAG chair, the option. I want to do quick one-minute introductions from all of you so that we know who's in the room from the national and regional IGFs. And perhaps I'll do that first, Yanis, so you know who's with us. And then I would like to welcome your comments, please. May I do that? Thank you. So let me start, first of all, Mark, I'll just start with you and Ellen, and we'll just go around the room, and your name, whether your formal affiliation, and then if you are with one of the national or regional IGFs, and what your function is there.
My name is Mark Buell. I'm the Senior Communications Advisor for the Canadian Internet Registration Authority, which is the registry for the .ca top-level domain. And I'm the coordinator of the Canadian IGF.
I'm Ellen Strickland, and I'm Community Program Director for Internet New Zealand, which we're .nz, as well as a civil society charity. And I am project lead for NetHui, which is the New Zealand Internet Governance event.
I just want to also mention, Marilyn speaking again, we're going to be handing out a sign-in sheet, which is asking for the same kind of information. Please print your email address, because some of you write as though you are a medical doctor, and we are having difficulty making sure we have your email addresses correct. We want to update the coordinators list. So you'll see, and the second point I was going to make is one of the real examples, I think, of the diversity and innovation in the national and regional IGFs. You've already heard two very different titles for the coordinators' roles. Thank you.
Hi, I'm David. Okay. Hi, I'm David Viorst, co-chair of the IGF USA, executive director of ISOC DC, and co-founder of Relay Station Digital Strategies.
Hello, I'm Alberto Perez, working for Red.es, a government agency in charge of promoting internet and also managing the .es domain name. And I'm here representing IGF Spain.
Hi, good morning. My name is Flavio Wagner. I'm a member of the board of TGIBR. I'm not directly responsible for the national IGF in Brazil, but we have been organizing the national IGF for 5 years, and I'm here on behalf of the organizers, which are also board members of CGI.
I'm Sylvia Bidard. I'm a general director of ILETI, the ICT Federal Federation of the Industry of Ibero-Latin America. I'm also vice president of WITSA. I'm a MAC member. And since last August, I'm part of the ecosystem of the ICF Regional Latin America. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Liana Galstian from Armenia. I'm the board member and a public relations manager of ISOC Armenia. And I'm a member of the organizational committee of Armenian IGF, which is a rather new initiative.
Although I picked up all the compliments, thank you, Marilyn. My name is once again Anya Gengo, and I'm a fellow at IGF Secretariat based in Geneva.
Hi, I'm Mike Nelson. I work for Cloudflare. I'm based in Washington, D.C. I'm on the MAG, and I'm also very involved in IGF USA, have been for several years.
My name is Maktar Sek. I'm working for United Nations Economic Commission for Africa. We host the African IGF with African Union. And also at the UNECA, we drive the process of YCCs in Africa.
Hi, my name is Mary Uduma. I'm from Nigeria. I'm the convener of Nigerian IGF, and I chair the local MAG of Nigeria IGF. I'm also with the .ng. I've just retired as the president of the board, but I'm still there working with the organization that manages the .ng, that's NIRA. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Saeed Zazai, and I'm from Afghanistan. I work for the government, but I'm not representing government here. I'm representing a civil society. It's a relatively new initiative in the country, and I'm also pleased to say that we are actually hosting a remote participation hub for IGF for the first time in Afghanistan, and they're probably in another workshop, not here right now.
Hi, I'm Shane Tews. I'm the vice chair of the IGF USA with David. And I'm also with a group called the American Enterprise Institute as a visiting fellow working on global internet strategy.
Hi, I'm Fotion Kosta from Albania. I'm head of ICT department, Ministry of Energy and Industry. And I'm planning to create an IGF in Albania too.
And I want to thank you especially for that your willingness to even contribute to the survey in an advanced way. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Laura Hutchison from Nominet. We run the .UK country code and provide a secretariat for the UK IGF.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Marilyn, for introducing and convening this session and the team. My name is Mark Carvel. I'm with the UK government. The Department for Culture, Media and Sport, which leads on internet governance policy. I'm a member of the MAG, and I'm also a member of the steering committee for the UK IGF, similar to the US experience, which you recounted, Marilyn. From the very start, the UK government thought it was very important to have a preparatory process for UK stakeholders to gear up for this new experiment in governance, the IGF, and working closely with Nominet on that. So we've been very much partners in developing the UK IGF. The UK Internet Minister, Ed Vasey, who unfortunately can't be at this global IGF, he's been at the previous four IGFs, has always been very active in the UK IGF, and that's a sign of closely. We want to be engaged and want to support the UK IGF. I should also mention the Commonwealth IGF, which is a forum which we've convened in the past within the context of the global IGF, and we have actually a Commonwealth Open Forum tomorrow at 11 o'clock for those Commonwealth stakeholder colleagues who are here. And there is the possibility, which is starting to develop, to hold a standalone Commonwealth IGF in India next year. So, thank you.
Hello, my name is Sandra Hoferichter. I'm Secretary General for the EuroDIC, the European IGF, and I'm based in Germany.
I'm Paul Brigner. I am the co-convener of the Washington, D.C. chapter of the Internet Society, and I've been involved in the Washington, D.C. IGF USA.
John Moore, also a co-convener of the D.C. chapter of the Internet Society, and been active in D.C. chapter for many years.
Good morning. My name is Leopold Adjakpa. I'm a business consultant. I'm a member of AFICTA.
Bom dia. Arnold van Rijn from the Netherlands, the Ministry of Economic Affairs. I'm also organizing the our national IGF.
Irem Borisova. I've been participating and active in IGF USA since the very beginning. I also work for VeriSign. We've been sponsoring both the global IGF and IGF USA since the very beginning as well, and we are very glad to see how well they're both doing.
So I should just say before we go on that at one point we introduced scenario stories at the IGF USA, and Erin made the first field visit that a national IGF had made. She and another colleague of hers, Shane Tews, who are here, when we did a partnership between the Russian IGF and IGF USA. So I, as we talk about innovations and ideas of sharing, I just wanted to think about some of the history that has emerged and initiatives that some of you may have also done like that.
Good morning. I'm Guilford Apanyengwi from Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe IGF, I am the current chairman of the Zimbabwe IGF, 3 months old. Not me, but the IGF. I'm also responsible for the .ac.zw. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Christina Monti. I work at the European Commission in DG Connect, in a team that deals with internet governance. And the European Commission is also a partner of Eurodig. Thank you.
I'm Hugo Cordova. I come from the European Parliament, the Secretariat. And we have a big delegation this year. We passed from 3 to 9 members. That's it.
I'm Garland McCoy with the Technology Education Institute, and I've been involved since Rio in the IGF, and I think from the beginning with the IGF USA, and very committed all along on the Connecting the Next Billion initiatives, or Global Connector, so work in that particular area.
And I think I saw Kosi come in. Benin? No?
Bonjour, moi c'est Vivien Assangbe. Excusez-moi de parler français, comme c'est ma langue d'origine. Je suis du secteur privé au Bénin et je fais partie de l'IGF au Bénin. Donc, on essaie de faire pousser le Bénin sur tout ce qui concerne l'informatique, les nouvelles technologies au niveau du Bénin. Merci.
Okay. We will take any other introductions when they arrive, but I'd like now to recognize that we've been joined by Yannis Karklins, the MAG chair, and I'd like to welcome him and ask him to share. Yannis has been a very strong supporter of the growth of the national and regional IGFs, and when we convened a small informal meeting in Paris during the MAG meeting, came and joined us during that lunch period to hear further thoughts, and I know he has some ideas and thinking about the importance of the national and regional IGFs. So to you, Chair.
So thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me to the meeting. Let me step back a little bit and start with the 10 years ago when the first IGF was convened in Athens, and so we were very happy to be together, and clearly that demonstrated how valuable this multi-stakeholder dialogue was. Since then, I'm more than pleased to note that there are more than 30 national, regional IGF initiatives that have been established basically on all continents except one. This is Antarctica, but otherwise it is almost everywhere. The mere fact of existence of those national and regional initiatives proves that this dialogue is absolutely necessary to prepare decision-making process whether at national or regional level. So then IGF experienced some, let's say, difficulties after certain period of time. The Commission Science and Technology for Development address the issue and establish the working group on improvements of IGF. And this working group produced recommendations. And one of the recommendations is or was to make sure that the global IGF becomes more relevant to all stakeholders at national and regional level. And that IGF should produce something more tangible for the benefit of everyone. So putting these two recommendations together, last year we in the MAG when we discussed this, we thought that it would be very useful maybe to engage with the national and regional initiatives and kind of create a loop where activities of national regional IGFs would feed in IGF, global IGF, and so we developed a proposal to address the theme of policy menu for Next Billion Online. And I'm very grateful to all those national regional IGF initiatives for taking up and contributing the outcome of your discussions to the document which will be discussed today and will be presented to the main session I think day after or tomorrow or today in the afternoon. Yeah. Of course, one can argue that this was kind of imposed on regional and national IGFs, the theme. And I think that we should maybe look at other alternatives, how to sort of assign a topic or two. Though I would prefer one, but nevertheless. I think that your meeting today would be maybe the best venue to talk about this theme. And if you support this idea of continuation of linking national regional IGFs on one topic, so then your meeting today would be maybe the best opportunity to talk about this potential theme and come up with a proposal. Then we could. We could endorse and carry this intersessional work throughout the year, and that would be your theme and your contribution, and we could sort of accommodate that within the program of IGF 2016. And I'm very confident saying that because co-facilitators yesterday were absolutely clear that the probability that high-level meeting will not extend or would not extend the mandate of IGF is almost non-existent. So therefore, though, never say hop before jumping, but we can be fairly confident that there will be IGF 2016, 17, 18, 19, 20, and up to 25. So therefore, I would encourage you maybe to analyze your experience of this year, tell us what did work, what didn't, what type of interaction you would like to see, or how process should be shaped if you are in agreement that this should be continued, and how that result should be fed in the next year's IGF. So that type of reflection and advice from your meeting today would be extremely helpful for the MAG thinking about next year's program and creating this cooperation mechanism, which certainly is completely volunteer and not imposed. So that all of us we can benefit from experiences and our knowledge.
So I'm going to respond to the MAG chair, Marilyn Kate. I'm going to respond to the MAG chair by referencing something that is in our agenda and taking credit for the fact that actually, during our survey, Yanis, and with the reflection already of the input from many of the coordinators, if you look down toward the last two bullets, one of the things that we're going to talk about is the theme. It was identified. I wouldn't have called it a theme. I would have called it a topic. But in our survey, the theme of creating this feedback loop, this reflection from the IGF into the national and regional IGFs, and from the national and regional IGFs into the IGF, was one of the two topics that received the most interest of discussing, a discussion here, as well as identifying, following up on the meeting we had, informal discussion we had in Paris, how to double the number of the national IGFs by the 2016. There are many challenges that the national and regional IGFs face that we are also going to talk about for reflecting back to the Secretariat and to the MAG on what additional support can be given to address those challenges. I think what I've seen is actually a great enthusiasm about contributing to the intersessional work, and the results of our survey, which we're going to go through now, show that there's a very strong linkage already with organizing of workshops, participation in dynamic coalitions, contributing to connecting the next billion, but it's not visible. It's not as visible as we would like to see it. But I really welcome your comments, and I wonder if you might take questions from...
Maybe when you think about the theme, like this year, the basically theme was access. That what are policies in different parts of the world in order to increase access. So I would encourage also to think in terms of substantive themes that would be where we could share our knowledge and experiences on something which would be development oriented or let's say rights based orientation or something rather than process orientation. I understand that it is important to discuss about challenges that national regional initiatives may face, and certainly to share those experiences among coordinators of these initiatives. But for the broader public, it is more substance that is of great interest. So one thing that comes to mind, for instance, is local content. How to ensure that local content is created, and because that is another side of the coin of bringing more people online. It's not just to give them computer and access. So if there is no content, then most probably they will go once, and second time they won't. Or education, the skills, literacy, making sure that everyone knows that the first entry on search engine not necessarily is absolute truth, and so on. So there are plenty of topics that we could think about.
Do we have questions? While we have Yanis with us, I don't think he's able to stay the entire time. The next thing we're going to do is go through our survey, but I'm going to take a cue. I see I have, so I should just say one thing. You're probably terribly curious why there are so many people attending from IGF USA, and obviously it's because they need to supervise me, right? Or I'm trying to set a new standard of encouraging all of you to bring all of your participants as well. I'm going to start with Mary and then go to Mike. And do I have anyone else?
My name is Mary, again for the records, and I'm from Nigeria, IGF. And I want to thank Janice. He remotely participated in our Nigerian IGF and made a presentation on connecting. We tagged on connecting the next 50 million Nigerians to online, and the issues that were raised there were. But what I want to ask is, are we trying to formalize this relationship? Are we tagging? Are we going to be, is this process going to formalize the relationship, the linkages between the MAG, the IGF, the regional, the national, and the down the line.
Actually, I'm going to preempt the MAG chair on that question, Mary, and because we'll talk more about this. The MAG chair, let's do the thematic topics and other kinds of things, because I think this is more a secretariat question.
Okay. All right.
No,
thank you.
From systemic point of view, I don't know. If there is a need, we can think about it. Technically or legally speaking, there is no link between, at least for the moment, between global IGF, which is convened by UN Secretary General, and national initiative. So we're creating that link now. We need to see how it works, whether that is useful or not. And if that is useful, so we may think about kind of association or coalition or whatever with a kind of formalized relationship, if that is needed and helpful.
Mike Nelson with Cloudflare in Washington. As a member of the MAG, I found one of the most useful things coming out of the regional and national IGFs have been proposals based on sessions that were held in the regional and national IGFs. It's great to see when people have brought a new topic into the process and they have identified great speakers. Sometimes you can even watch the session and see how good it was. But we don't see enough of that in my mind. I'm just wondering whether anybody in the room thinks there's a way to encourage more of that sort of feeding process. It's a little bit like the TEDx talks that feed into the TED conference. You know, it would be a great way to maybe if each of the local groups could highlight, you know, two or three amazing sessions that were new and different, and encourage people to feed that into the global IGF. Any thoughts on how we might encourage that, Yanis?
No, I think these jewels we need to look for and share that information because certainly in every part of the world we have something that others may not have because of number of circumstances and as I tend to say, the beauty of internet is we do not know in which garage which kid is working on something that in 5 years will become a billion user application. So the same applies here. We don't know, and information sharing, and that's why this network of national regional IGFs is, in my view, very, very helpful.
There's also amazing things that might be going on in government agency offices that the rest of the world can learn from as well. And this brings up the second point, which is there a way we can get more resources so that the IGF can do more with this incredibly rich content that's being generated here at the IGF and in some cases at the IGF regional ones? Because we've got a lot of great material. As a professor, I've used some of it, but not everybody knows that some of the best sessions on these topics are here.
I think that conditions now are much better than they used to be 6 months ago, because IGF Secretariat has hired a webmaster, a person who is dedicated to work exclusively on IGF website. You know that there was some time ago a financial crisis and the IGF website was, let's say, maintained to fulfill bare minimum requirements. And community initiative was proposed, and friends of IGF created, I wouldn't say alternative site, but the audiovisual site, collected rich material and put it in a searchable way. I think the now task is to find a way, avoiding all, let's say, legal limitations that exist because of the affiliation with the United Nations, which is highly regulated environment, to cooperate to incorporate or link both websites, and certainly improve the IGF website. And so I believe that in next IGF we will clearly see improvements in that respect as well.
Thank you.
Let me just build on that. I'm going to go to Arnold next. Some of the things that our survey, which was focused on process and procedures, so we wouldn't take up the time on that, did identify the kinds of ideas that the Secretariat might be able to offer to the national and regional IGFs, which would be the kind of tactical support, et cetera. So we're going to talk about that later, and Mike may get that question answered, and if not, the transcript will answer it. I'm going to go to Arnold first, I think, and then to Mark, because I'm kind of just building a queue, and then I have someone in the back.
Thank you, Marilyn, and thank you, Yanis, for your explanation. Indeed, there's a lot of work ahead of us to strengthen this interaction between national, European, regional, and the global IGF. It's not only about seeking themes where we can strengthen this relationship, but it's also about processes. I think in particular that there's a special role for the MAC to stir up this interaction. I think MAC members should know what national IGFs are looking for in their preparation for the global IGF. To name a concrete example, the Netherlands IGF, in this special year of celebrating 10-year IGF, thought, well, we should have a very thrilled program going forward to Brazil. So the program was really linked to hot topics, policy topics like Internet of Things, online platforms, privacy as a enabler of economic growth. And I attended the MAC meeting, very valuable MAC meetings we had, and as an observer, I tried to, through the MAC, try to get this link with the global IGF. So we proposed, or I proposed, some workshops, and finally we got a good result, I must say. And Internet of Things, in relationship to ethics, this is something we are now discussing here in Brazil. It is a responsibility of the national IGF to have a good preparation for the global IGF. And on the other hand, it's also a responsibility of the MAC members to see where there is discussions going on in the different countries. And so my strong wish is that national IGFs around the world should see contact with the MAC members in the preparation for the global IGF to get this linkage, to let them know this is really what we are discussing in our country, and this is really important to follow up. So this is what my thoughts are to get a better interaction. I would like to know what your reaction is on this.
So, I understand where you're coming from. Well, a word of caution is I think that the national and regional IGFs first and foremost should address issues of importance at the national and regional level, not that much look at global, because these are not subsidiaries of global IGF, vice versa. These are national IGFs which then may want to feed something to the global. This is kind of inverse equation, if you wish, but certainly we would like to hear as much as we can from experiences at national regional level. I think that there is also now a question whether IGF, the global IGF, should continue be organized in the way as it is, and this I think will be a responsibility of the MAG in the first meeting of the next cycle. To see whether we will continue with the completely bottom-up process as it is now, with a call for proposals, then receiving this year, I think we were very privileged to have more than 400.
It was a huge number.
Proposals, and we had a daunting task to select 120 best proposals following very clearly defined methodology, but that is a random still it does not maybe 100% reflect the maybe the whole the all desires or wishes of either countries or organizations or companies. So we need to look for a right balance in that respect. So hopefully we will find one. And but certainly not. I don't see that global IGF should dictate anything to national regional IGFs. So that's for sure.
So I'm going to close the queue. I have three questions. I see you in the back. I first of all have Mark, and then I see the microphone. So can we get the microphone to Mark?
Well, and then we'll go. Microphone is, please go ahead.
And then we'll go to Garland, and then we'll
you
come back.
You have your microphone. Just charge ahead. Yeah.
No. Excuse me. Sorry.
Okay, if I go ahead very briefly. First of all, very supportive of this proposal that we help identify key themes that will help the MAC, I'm sure, to have inputs from the national and regional IGFs in that regard. Am I? Okay,
perfect.
Sorry. So supportive of that proposal, that's very helpful, and certainly from my perspective as a MAG member, that's an important contribution that the MAG should help deliver through inputs from the national and regional IGFs. With regard to a theme or topic for the interaction of national and regional IGFs to contribute to the global IGF, certainly support that as a way forward. We think that's very important. As to how we would in the UK would approach that, we would have a process whereby we convene our steering committee to reflect on this IGF in its entirety, and then consider as one of an agenda item, as an agenda item, if you like, what can the UK IGF contribute to in terms of developing a theme intersessionally. So we will need to have that kind of step to be taken, and then we could submit something to that, which takes into account discussions today, certainly, and but in addition, what is going to happen at this IGF and ongoing themes and further work to be done as a result of this global IGF in its entirety. So that's how I see the kind of the steps for us to take to contribute to identifying that topic or two topics if we identify two.
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Ideally, if that would be known already now, if not, then but certainly we need to put kind of a cap in terms of time. Because this year we were bit late with identification of the theme, and as a result, some national IGFs have taken place already by the time theme was identified, or programming have been already advanced sufficiently that it was difficult to squeeze in a theme. So, but again, I would really love to see a proposal coming out from this group, because that will be a theme or topic which will unite all national regional initiatives in the run-up to the next IGF.
I'm gonna sorry, David, I've already closed the queue and I need to take the two speakers because we need to move on with our program and thank the chair. We can go on. I'm going to reverse the order because Sandra is a coordinator and I really appreciate you being here, but let me take Sandra's question first and then take yours unless we can deal with it later. And then, but I've closed the queue because we need to move on to the rest of our program. Sandra?
That was a nice way to say off you go.
You know, as much...
I'm joking.
as much as I love having the MAG chair here, gosh...
Thank you, Marilyn. I just want to underline what has been said by the previous speaker and give you an update. At Europe, we are also at the moment looking at possibilities how to better interlink the nationals with the sub-regionals and the regional and then feed into the global. We know this is a difficult task because there are two less resources, and I don't mean financial resources, I also mean the time to travel, time to participate, to organize. So we are looking into ways how to, as a regional IGF, how to actually offer a sort of a service or make it national IGF sometimes easier to organize their national events and to foster this development. We will look into this option a little bit closer by during the open forum on Friday this week, so everybody is invited to come and discuss this with us. There might be possibilities like we had a sub-regional IGF this year along with Eurodic in Sofia. CEDIC, the Southeastern European Dialogue on Internet Governance, was created. We decided, or we moved forward in terms of that we now have a joint call for proposals. So actually we are trying to bundle the resources from this call for proposals. The submitter can either choose if they want to submit their topic under the discussion of the Southeastern European focus or under the Eurodic or under both. So this was one way how we somehow try to align the processes in order to streamline it a little bit more. We will look into options how we can cooperate in this term with national IGFs. We were also thinking about defining themes. I think the intersessional work connecting the next billion, which was introduced by the global IGF this year, is also a very good step ahead, how we can actually work on a topic over the year. We will look in these options as well and see if this is a model for Europe. And we could think, although knowing that every national IGF has different conditions and you can put the process on top of them, I mean, it has to come from, it really has to come from a bottom-up perspective, we might think about that the region could actually coordinate themselves the way it works for them and then bring up the proposals and bring up the results to the global IGF. So this is actually the timeline, or these are the issues we want to look for the, let's say, next 5 years in the respect that the global IGF will, we are pretty sure, continue. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. My comment is, let's keep it light as possible, at least at the beginning, while we're sure that things work properly.
Thank you, Garland. You're the last speaker, and then I welcome you staying with us, Giannis, but we're going to move forward. I will just say that some of the ideas that have been mentioned here are also reflected in the survey. So when you see, you will receive the survey and the write-up, you'll see some reflection of that as well. Garland, you get the last word.
Institute. Just real quick, I've been with the program for 10 years now, and the quick question I had was whether you thought it was time to look at expanding particularly the stakeholders in the non-ICT areas, so that with the internet as ubiquitous and at least at one level. Obviously I'm committed to the connecting the next billion, but at one level ubiquitous, and there are so many financial institutions, resort hotels, commerce that's done on this platform, that perhaps bringing in more stakeholders that understand, you know, it's not an education process that needs to take place. They already understand how important the internet is to their line of work, to join us in connecting the next billion, in this policy work, in becoming disciples, if you will, in the various policy and areas we want to pursue. So just enlarging the participation base just a bit, if that's a worthy.
Yeah, no, fully agree. And that has been discussed in the MAG, and this is our objective, to attract other industries to IGF in order to learn from their experiences. So if you remember, for instance, maybe half a year ago, there was information that one flying aircraft was hacked. And honestly, no one would like to be on an aircraft which is hacked. So the airline industry certainly, or aviation industry certainly, has some experiences to share when it comes to cybersecurity and cyber defense, and that would clearly enrich our discussion and our understanding about the complexities. So automobile industry is another example. Banking goes without saying, everything is online. Yeah, long answer to your short question is yes.
Would you all join me in giving a round of applause and thanking our MAG chair? But before you do that, I just want to say something about what a terrific contribution that Yanis himself has made to enabling our success. I first met Yanis Karklins when he was the president of the the second preparatory process during the WSIS. And in the first preparatory process, stakeholders were not allowed in the room, and I had the opportunity to convince my boss, I worked at AT&T at the time, that it was worth his paying for me to fly to Geneva to hang out in the coffee shop at the Palais des Nations and buy coffee for the government negotiators. Through Yanis's leadership, really, he really helped a great deal in his role in helping to open up the and recognize the importance of bringing stakeholders in, and he's been a real champion in that. Yanis has also contributed significantly to the fact that we have been so fortunate as to have the UN co-facilitators come and join us. So do join me in thanking our MAG chair.
Thank you for your kind words. You made me feel uncomfortable.
Very welcome. I'm going to readjust the schedule just a little bit. I want to invite now to come and join us here at the front table, Chengatai Masanga, who is our secretariat. If I may, Chengatai. While Chengatai is coming to join us at the front, I'm going to give you a bit of an introduction. Most of you know Chengatai, but what you don't know is that Chengatai runs year-round business that most of you would, which has so many moving parts that it's really amazing. Each year, we deliver a bottom-up approach to planning and organizing the annual event. He also supports and engages with the national and regional IGFs, and he does that with a very minimal staff and with the volunteer help and the help of a very small part-time resource to some consulting support and to some fellows. And I have to tell you guys that when I was the vice president of health services at AT&T Computer Systems, I don't think I could have run my business by relying on volunteers and reporting to a group as creative as the MAG is, so, and working with the UN. So I think we have a great deal to say thanks about to our executive secretariat. I wanted him to come and talk to you a little bit and take a few questions before we move on about the national and regional IGFs, because he is really our resource to access to the staff I mentioned to you before and to access overall to the IGF.
Thank you very much, Marion, for those two kind words. You make me feel uncomfortable at the beginning, not at the end.
Yes, you understand it's a ploy I use so that we get more from you.
Okay, yes. I do work with a lot of great people, and this year it's been Anya, who's been mostly dealing with the regional and national IGF, so I think we should give her a hand of applause, too. Oh, they did? Well, do it again. We can do it twice. Yes. And yes, we feel that the regional and national IGF initiatives are very, very important, especially since this is a bottom-up process, and good governance begins at home. And we are now trying to integrate more the views between the two, so we're not acting separately, which I think we've done. You've done the initiatives, and also with the intersessional work. I would like to thank you all very much for contributing to that and also communicating with us and sending in your reports, etc. We also have our fellowship program, which I'm sure you all know about, where we try and invite people from developing countries to come and work at the IGF Secretariat, and Anya is one of them, so that when they go back, it helps encourage more of this integration and communication between the regional and national IGFs. And as soon as, I'll just say, as soon as this IGF is finished, I will also be sending an email out to all of you for nominations for the next round of fellows, especially for 2016. What else would I like to say? We used to have regular meetings of the regional and national IGFs, and I think we should really try and have those again. I think they were very, very helpful, and at least we can coordinate and also see the requirements for becoming a national and regional IGF initiative and a whole host of other things, because there's a lot of things that we can coordinate to and make, you know, the IGF process a much stronger process. I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
So, I want to thank you on behalf of all of the coordinators for the terrific support that you also gave us in doing our survey. And we're going to talk about the survey in a bit. I don't expect you to stay for it, but I just want to say that through the survey, as you know, we included questions about what kind of resources that the Secretariat could provide to the national and regional IGFs. And one of the things we uncovered is that although the Secretariat is very willing to provide WebEx and also audio conferencing to assist, that awareness was not fully understood by some of the national and regional IGFs. So some of our learning about, you know, even though there's, and the fact that there's a designated contact, Anja, for the national and regional IGFs, those kind of minor improvements are the kinds of things that I think we will come out of this. We did used to have, Changitai and I launched the first coordinators meeting several years ago. Those fell away, and one of the questions in our questionnaire was, would you like to resume those? And we got a resounding yes to that. So we'll be coming back on that. So I'm going to take two questions for Changitai, and then we need to move on with the program. Anybody have a burning question?
Oh, great.
Well, I have one burning question for him, but I know the answer. So we have benefited in the past at the IGF USA by having the physical presence of the Secretariat. And I know that you have been able to attend some of the national and regional IGFs. You've also participated remotely. Given the fact you have a very, very busy schedule, I really do understand that it's difficult for you to spend a lot of time on the road, so to speak. But looking ahead, I think we would like to ask you, after our meeting today, we'd like to come back to you and talk more about also the visibility of the Secretariat and you and others during the actual physical national IGFs and regional IGFs, because that's an important linkage as well.
Yes, thank you. I mean, I'm always willing to come and support the regional and national IGFs, but, you know, there's a few things to do, and time management is one of them. But, yes, we can talk about it and see how best, especially for 2016, how best we can do that. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you for joining us. I know you have a few things going on out there. Yes, please.
I almost got away.
I talk on behalf of the IGF Secretariat, in African IGF Secretariat. We had a good relationship with the IGF Secretariat last year. you attend to this meeting in Nigeria. We appreciate. I think we need to work more together with the IGF Secretariat in Geneva to be present on the sub-regional IGF in Africa. We need more emphasis at the sub-regional IGF. We have the regional IGF now is regularly between ECA and African Union. We run every year. Your presence also is highly appreciated. But now we need your presence and your support for the sub-regional IGF. I think my colleague Marisa has something to say about it, but she ran the IGF for West Africa.
Okay,
he
has said it.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Sorry, I also forgot
to mention the summer schools that are sometimes, that are attached. I mean, we talked about CEDEC. There's also the African Summer School, the South American Summer School. So going forward, we think these are very important and we should work together to see ways and how we can help support these summer schools, especially for the capacity building effort to help people more proactively engage in the internet governance discourse.
Go on with our program. You are very welcome to stay if you'd like to do that. I'm going to readjust the agenda because we have some substantive discussions and we have the review of the survey. And I think if I may consult with my two co-moderators, let's go with the substantive discussion on WSIS plus 10, if you don't mind. And then we will go do Connecting the Next Billion because we have some expert speakers here. And then we will review the survey because we can review the survey with you in a written report. Is that okay with everyone if we do that switch? Okay. We're going to talk about WSIS Plus 10 first. And let me just mention that during the development of the MAG discussion, and there are several MAG members here, I made the proposal that we have a substantive session about on the consultation on the WSIS Plus 10 review. The MAG supported that, and all of you were able to attend and participate in that very unusual session yesterday morning because we did have the active listening of the two UN co-facilitators and their staff. But drawing out of that, several of the national and regional IGFs also held their own sessions where they also took up WSIS Plus 10. And I'm going to ask a few of the folks who led that or moderated that session within their national IGF to just share a few views with us, both about the idea of bringing such an obscure global topic into your national or regional IGF and how you experienced the response to this since, as I was reminded by Ambassador Fonseca when I came here, that WSIS Plus 10 may be very, and the extension of the IGF may be very much on the minds of the MAG, but the majority of the attendees at the national and regional IGFs do not know or care about what WSIS Plus 10 is. But we brought it to some of them at the national level. I'm gonna kick off with Peter Dengue-Thrush just because I know he ended up chairing the town hall session that we held in at the IGF USA. We were somewhat probably favored by our proximity to New York and the fact that I was able to invite attendance and an active listening mode of a staff person from the one of the co-facilitator staff. But Peter chaired the WSIS Plus 10 session at IGF USA. Can I see a show of hands of others? I believe Sandra, there was also, and I know that the African IGF also had a session on WSIS Plus 10. So if I could start with Peter and then come to here and come to you, Ellen, and to Mark. Thank you.
Yeah, that's fine. Good morning, everybody. Peter Dengue-Thrush. I'm sorry I missed the first part of the session, and if I repeat anything, I apologize. So, yes, I had the great pleasure of participating in the USA IGF in Washington this year. tribute to David Vorst, who I think is here, who was part of the organising committee. The whole day was chaired brilliantly by Shane. I was asked to take the moderating role of the session on the WSIS plus 10. We ended up with six speakers. We started with former Ambassador David Gross, who had been the leader of the United States delegation at the time of the WSIS. And we then moved forward through civil society speaker Matthew Shears from CDT, Laura Donatis from academia. Marilyn, help me, who else did we have? A very full range of views, taking us through, explaining, recognising always that with any issue like this, there are people in the room who knew absolutely nothing about it and for whom the acronym was brand new, and others, including several of us who'd actually been there and participated and fought the fight in the trenches. So we worked our way forward from what the event was, and then spent most of the time looking at a timeline of what were, because at that stage the process was just kicking off. The co-facilitators had just been appointed, and we were explaining what the mission was to try and explain the importance of this particular topic to the community and how they could participate, including what the actual time points in the process were for interventions by companies, by civil society, by government. So there's one of, Marion was another speaker in the back there. Sorry, Marion. So I'm not sure whether I can say much more. It was a very well attended session. I think we had a completely full room, standing room only, 85 to 90 sort of people in a room about the size of this. Lots of questions afterwards, and as Marilyn pointed out, we had one of the UNDESA staff present, so we're able to carry on the lobbying, which eventually led to the successful visit here of the two co-facilitators. And congratulations again to you, Marilyn, for the session yesterday. I think that was extraordinary, resulting as it did in the ability to input the views of the multi-stakeholder community into the multilateral process. I think that's a nice, significant step.
I'm going to go on with, so who's the next speaker on WSIS Plus 10, and then we can take questions from the floor, is that okay? Who's the next speaker on WSIS Plus 10, or am I going to come up here? Sandra? Nope, okay. Yes, please.
I'm going to talk about the WSIS Plus 10 in Africa. At UNECA, UNECA, we organized this year's review, the 10-year review for Africa. And we invite all government, around 40 African government attended the meeting we organized in Addis Ababa. And before the meeting, UNECA undertook a study for the 10-year review to discuss during the review meeting. And it was very interesting, but the study provided the progress made by African countries during the 10 years, and also identify some challenge and gap. And the review identify also four additional action line or priority area beyond 2015. And we can highlight if we have some during the discussion, the four additional area we found for African country. And when during the meeting, we have more attendance from the government because it is UNECA is a united organization, UN process working more with the government. And we bring this discussion during the African IGF with APC. It was a very interesting discussion because we have the participation of the civil society and a lot of people from private sector and also some government, African government, and there was very interesting debate. And we also have a discussion on the white paper to see how the priority for Africa are included. And we have a similarity between the priority identified beyond 2015 and the discussion we had during this meeting. And this white paper integrate all needs for Africa beyond 2015. I think it's a very good experience to have this mixity between WSIS Plus 10 and IGF. It's very important. Yesterday, during the WSIS Plus 10 discussion, there is one proposal from one participant to have together IGF and WSIS in order to give more opportunity to the civil society to know about WSIS. known to participate about VC, because the problem we have in Africa, in IGF, we don't have too many government involved in the IGF process. But the VC process, all government are there. Why I think to organize together or back to back at the regional level, which is plus 10 review, which is review, and IGF is very important, is what I want to say about what we did in Africa on which is plus 10 and African IGF. Thank you.
Out a similarity of how that was handled in the United States. Marion Gordon, who is somewhere in the room, Marion Gordon for the United States State Department coordinates the WSIS stakeholder engagement. And so it was actually a parallel process very broadly within the United States, but Marion then participated and helped to contribute to the WSIS session both as an expert speaker and bringing the and reflecting the broader consultation that was going on. So to me, it was very, you know, done in a different way and without and with one government and one country, but reflecting that same linkage as well. Let me go on to, yes, Marion, please.
Thank you, Marilyn. You know what struck me in the. In Washington, D.C., when we had this conversation at the U.S., IGF U.S., was that it seemed so appreciated by the parties that were in that were at the IGF. For us to have any sort of success, we have to talk to one another. I know that for those of you who've been following the fortunes of WSIS, UNDESA was in the meeting and remarked during the meeting that if only they could get the message out similarly in other countries. So this isn't to take the mic to tell you just how fabulous we are, but rather to just say this is a model that seemed to be appreciated by the participants of the IGF, and even further was appreciated by the leadership of the UN in terms of trying to throw the net wide to get really important feedback at critical moments. Thank you.
So I guess maybe one other takeaway, it's Marilyn, that I would take out of this is perhaps we need to I know Anja's not here, but it'll be in the transcript and we can capture it, this idea of, so how do we create these kinds of linkages for other national and regional coordinators so that they too can reach into UNDESA or reach into bringing an outside resource into, to perhaps stimulate interest in this kind of engagement. Ellen, if I may go to Net Huey's approach.
So I think I'll keep it brief, but I just, it's always interesting to share, and I certainly echo some of the same sentiments, that we this year actually had a similar approach, I believe, Marilyn, so that Internet NZ worked, had a separate process with our foreign affairs, where we had a consultation group that we brought together of civil society and interested actors, and had a meeting and an email list that helped inform the session that happened at NetHui. And the key contact at foreign affairs with responsibility was the facilitator for the NetHui session. And I think what I wanted to share is it was really interesting to us. We put it in one of the smaller rooms. We have done a lot of work to sort of do capacity building and education within NetHui in the plenary sessions and help people understand the international context over the last 5 years. But sessions dedicated to international internet governance have historically been very poorly attended. It's something that in a bottom-up national environment there just wasn't a lot of interest in. You'd get a handful of people who are already engaged. And that this year was the first time that we had a full room and a lot of people that have had nothing to do with UN processes or WSIS, that had started through being involved in internet governance processes through NetHui for a few years, had started having questions about how it works above, how with the UN and intergovernmental and internationally. And so we just had an excellent session where which was really helpful to be fed in by that preparatory process with stakeholders and having Foreign Affairs talk about the overarching process, getting engagement from the community, so partly just understanding WSIS and WSIS Plus 10 and the broader international, but also we talked about specific action items and how they relate to New Zealand and what sort of how the process goes from here and what inputs opportunities for people. So we were really pleased with it, and I think the main takeaway for me is the importance of having national and local initiatives for people to develop understanding and engage with the concept of international internet governance.
Ellen, before I go to Mark and then come back to others here, so would your takeaway be that through this consultation and engagement, you influenced the decisions and the actions that your government would take in New York?
I believe our government is very open and supportive of multi-stakeholder approaches, and so there absolutely was influence from across from these processes into preparation and how they're engaging now and through to December. And to their credit, the New Zealand government absolutely believes that's the right way to go about it and saw the process and NetHui as the right way to be part of the WSIS preparation process and for them to get what they needed to engage properly in the process.
Mark?
So in October of 2015, we partnered with the Canadian Commission for UNESCO and worked closely with our Foreign Affairs Department to hold an intersessional consultation on WSIS Plus 10. We convened a group of about 30 Canadians in an open facilitated discussion about WSIS Plus 10 guided by the zero draft, which was out at the time. And really the goal was to identify what are Canadians' priorities within the WSIS Plus 10 process and what role can Canadians play in ICT4D. A significant portion of that discussion focused on connecting the next billion, of course. The resulting outcome document from that we actually submitted to the WSIS Plus 10 process as a comment on the zero draft, and it's actually available on the WSIS Plus 10 website. It was a really interesting experience to draw 30 diverse stakeholders together to talk about something that for the most part we don't talk about very much in Canada, and I think it was a great learning experience for those in attendance, for us, and our government partners like Foreign Affairs.
Okay, do I have someone else who wants to talk about how you discussed WSIS Plus 10 at your national initiative? Arnold, did you? Yes.
Yes. If you ask a man or a woman in the street, what do you think of WSIS? They start just saying, what the hell is this? I mean, kind of a terrorist organization or so? No. We just started to explain at our national IGF really what WSIS is. It was my task to do that. And so I start thinking, what is the easiest way to get this bridge to our stakeholders? So I talked about a global digital agenda. In particular, to bridge the digital divide. We have our own national digital agenda. There's a European digital agenda. There are other countries working hard on their own digital agenda, but WSIS is all about a new digital, global digital agenda. So that was for the first step. Second step was just to explain what is really behind it. Yes, we talk about human rights. We talk about how to create more trust in the ICT infrastructure. We're talking about capacity building. How can we work together with our partners? We call our stakeholders our partners from the government point of view. And so I also mentioned a concrete example. We organized a workshop in Kenya, how to combat spam, and we really came across with the suggestion or the proposal that if you have to combat crime, you should work together with the expertise which is all around us, with the expertise from the tech community, the private sector. That's the what we call the public-private partnerships. That's what we see in the Netherlands as the way forward to combat these cybercrime and other issues. So that landed very well in Kenya. And this is food for stuff which I think can be elaborated a bit more. Human rights is in the Netherlands a very important issue. And so I saw some sparkling eyes in the room. We had about 115 participants. And they approached me and wanted to help as well to try to bridge the digital divide, because we have our Freedom Online Coalition. It was initiated together with the United States in The Hague a couple of years ago, and this, the main task is also to help understand other countries and stakeholders that human rights offline is equal to human rights online. So by explaining more about what WSIS is, and of course the link with the new mandate we hope to get in December, you saw lots of people in the room saying, well, this is really important, so we are going to support you. We have our own ideas to help you, so this will get a follow-up in the near future. Just this is our experience we had.
Hi, Edmund Chung here from, I guess, the Secretariat for the Asia-Pacific Regional IGF. Just on, I guess, on the topic, we did have a session at the Regional IGF earlier in Macau. I personally wasn't there, so I'm just reading from a little bit from the report. I think the session was went through, of course, some of the background information, but also I think one of the highlights of it was that in previous preparations, one of the highlights is about preparations towards the WSIS was 10 in the Asia Pacific region. We used to have much more substantive input into the process in the past, but this particular time round, for example, the Asia Pacific telecommunity, the APT, didn't really have a platform for, I guess, synthesizing the input from the Asia Pacific region, and I guess that's one of the push from, you know, that would the community needs to come together further. You know, in the past there has been like a Tokyo Declaration of 2003, a Taiwan Declaration of 2005. We're kind of missing that, you know, going into the WSIS plus 10. Another thing that was highlighted is from the civil society and the lack of space for the input leading up to WSIS plus 10, and especially, you know, I guess I'd identified some of the items about net neutrality, freedom of expression, those kind of things. But one of the things that was interesting, I think, was brought up also is the concept or whether they're compatible or confusing between the multilateral discussion and multi-stakeholder concept, and that occupied a good chunk of the time of discussion there, and that's, I think, the some of the conclusions leading out to it is I guess the from the Asia Pacific to at least going forward to continue what was done better in the last round to have more substantive input into the process. So that's kind of the session. I don't know whether my colleagues want to add to it because I wasn't in the room at that time.
I think
no. That was what happened from the Asia Pacific Regional IGF.
I think I saw somebody in the very back of the room, and then I want to come up to McCain, and then I'll come to you if I may, Sylvia. But
hi.
You had, maybe you would stand up as well, so we could see you.
I'm Christiana Gonzalez. I work for
APC, and I am a representative of civil society for the LAC IGF. And on this topic of WISIS plus 10, we couldn't debate this in the regional IGF, but the main problem was that WISIS plus 10 discussion was not very concrete for Latin Americans. So they could not see how all this discussion on WISIS plus 10 were going to affect their daily use of internet. So I think that the main role that the global IGF could play on this was to make all those international and global discussions more close to regional realities. I don't want to speak for that. No. So my colleague here is also from the Latin America committee for like IGF.
Well, let me welcome both of you for coming. I do have a question for everyone in just a minute. Let me come back to you, please, McCain. And then I'll come to Sylvia. And then I have a question for all of you. If we can get the microphone for you. I'll give you this one, Sean. While we're getting the microphone, I will tell you that originally our room was set up in a open square, but I think we got preempted.
I would like to come back to the discussion we had during the WISIS review in Africa. Additionally to the 11 action line, we identified 4 topics to discuss and to propose for the WISIS beyond 2015. The first, it is the linkage between the WISIS action line and sustainable development goal. We found to sustain the ICT environment, we need to promote technology and innovation. It's very important for African country and for developing country. Donc we focus more on one pillar on how to use technology and innovation to sustain the development for Africa. Also, we linkage this WISIS plus 10 and the conference we organized in Addis Ababa, the financing for development outcome we organized in Addis Ababa in July last year. And we found we should have one topic on financing and resource mobilization. How to mobilize resources to finance the infrastructure in Africa, such as the broadband. It's a very important topic we discussed. Also, we are a member of the partnership for ICT measurement, but we should expand more to the statistic side, how to promote data revolution on ICT sector. It is another pillar. And the last one is also the issue of cybersecurity, view on peace and security in Africa. We have a lot of attack. We have this Boko Haram, this, you have another in Ghana, in Mali, and the terrorism use ICT tools. And we need to look at the cyber security to another side, how to protect our citizens. And what is it is the 4 additional output you would like to discuss during the WISIS plus 20. Plus during the WISIS beyond 2015. Thank you.
Let me go to Sylvia, but before Sylvia speaks, I'm going to pose my question so you can be thinking about it. I'm actually very familiar with the impact that the national IGF, the IGF USA has on reaching the US government, because they're very, they have many, many representatives who are on the steering committee and actively engaged. And so I know the answer for the IGF USA, and one of the co-chairs is still here. But my question to you is, do you know whether or not your government filed comments into the UN on WISIS plus 10, and do you know what those comments are? Mm-hmm. Sylvia.
Yes, and not too many. Well, the WISIS process in Latin America and the Caribbean is taken under the UN area for cooperation and development, which is ECLAC. And where they have the secretariat and the governments and the civil society and the private sector work together. It's a very, very good example. Even the region is not the best region in many senses. In this area, we are working together. And there is a very good community, and it's open to everybody. So my point is, you have to make it happen, whether it is WISIS, whether it is ICF, both together, you have to make it happen. We cannot complain anymore. We have to make it. It's up to us. And in the case of ICF and WISIS plus 10, we had a ministerial meeting of ELAC this year in Mexico, and before that, the ICF LAC was made. And the topics were similar to ICF as well. So this is the point of Latin America. Make it happen. Thank you.
Yes, Yusuf. I thank you, sir. Yes.
Thanks. Yusuf Moisander speaking as the chairman of the preparatory process for the Finnish National IGF, the Finnish Internet Forum. Joining Arnold, I mean, very good description of the way people see WISIS, or they don't understand it. We didn't have this year at our event a session on WISIS plus 10, for a few reasons I'll list them, but we've had WISIS on the agenda of the National IGF pretty much every year since we started in 2010. Firstly, we had the event already in February, and for various reasons, one of them being that we have national parliamentary elections in April. So there wasn't much to discuss at that stage. Also, I'm coordinating our national multi-stakeholder WISIS activities, and that same group then decided to organize the national IGF, and we're pretty much the same stakeholders doing it. So we consider the national IGF not to be a once a year event, but instead a process. So we have a distribution list of the participants. I'm on Twitter. We have an email, like a short list of about 50 people who are active. And so we can whenever we feel like there's a need to discuss from the government side. Just to be clear, I'm with the foreign ministry. So we call for a meeting of the IGF organizers or for a meeting of the WISIS stakeholders, and we discuss these issues. And just as an example, when we got the first zero draft, we had the following Monday, I think, a meeting to discuss it and to do the Finnish input. So we're open. We also had a video bridge to the CSTD secretariat to go through it with the Finnish colleague, former colleague who used to work for us and now is with the CSTD. So we had a very timely, very good discussion amongst the stakeholders who are interested. So it's not just about the annual event, it's about the process throughout the year. Thanks.
Flavio, we need to get you a microphone. Flavio? I'm going to do Flavio, come back to you, and then I'm going to make a suggestion, a proposal.
So, responding to your question about a proposal from the Brazilian government was filed to the UN, and they invited the Brazilian Internet Steering Committee for a consultation. So I would say, since CGI is already a multi-stakeholder committee, mm-hmm. we had representatives from different stakeholder groups invited to this consultation meeting with the Brazilian Ministry of External Affairs, which was responsible for preparing the submission and filing it to the UN. So it was not an open consultation with the society. It was more or less a consultation with other ministries and with CGI. CGIBR itself also filed a submission. We set up a working group inside CGIBR with representatives from all stakeholder groups also, and had several meetings and prepared a submission that we submitted. We did not have a session on WISIS plus 10 during our national IGF. We just gave some information to the attendees on that, but not
there was not really a discussion on that. And I fear, as already mentioned here, that those more complex international themes would not attract too many attendees to a session. So mostly discussions during the national IGF are more related to the things that are more concrete to the attendees there in Brazil.
Several of the national and regional IGFs ended up with messages from Euridig, et cetera. As a matter of fact, really interesting, you'll see in the survey that a growing number of the initiatives now have a formal, it's not an outcome, but it's a formal output of some kind or another. Did any of you, I know CGI did, .BR did any of you as national or regional IGF submit comments as stakeholders into the WSIS Plus 10 process? Not as the government, but as a stakeholder. You did, I think, Mark, yes. Right? Mm-hmm. And yes, I think you guys did, Sylvia. One of the things that I'm thinking about is I think we're missing the exchange of information about what each of us are doing in these kinds of areas that would be perhaps inspirational or, it would be good to know that another national initiative has done a review on WSIS Plus 10. Maybe they did a webinar to build awareness. In the United States, we are inundated with, in Washington, D.C., with all these additional opportunities to learn about things, think tanks, et cetera. So we can't be seen as the role model for what works in educating people about these very complex topics. But I'm thinking, when we come to the later in our session, that maybe we would want to think about having a kind of a one or two topics that are the hot lists that the coordinators would want to reach out to each other and share information and ideas on. Like, heads up, you can submit a stakeholder comment into the UN system, and here's why it's important. And here's somebody else who's doing it so that you might be able to share information with them. I want to take one more comment and then move on to our discussion about connecting the next billion and explain what's going to happen later this afternoon, but talk about what you said about connecting the next billion. And I believe I had a comment in the back.
Yes. Just a comment on the difference between ELAC and LAC-IGF. ELAC is an interministerial meeting. So we, civil society and other stakeholders, are only allowed to participate as observers and only one representative of each sector. So we recognize the effort of ELAC on discussing WSIS Plus 10 and doing the link between the global discussions and the regional one. But it is different having an interministerial meeting and a regional multi-stakeholder IGF.
Terrific. So I think we're ready to go to talking about connecting the next billion. Yes? I want to turn this over to the two co-moderators for that session, Ellen and Mark. And what we've done is start with the list of those who have submitted written comments into the intersessional work. Let me put into context what's going to happen later this afternoon to make sure that you're aware of that session and the linkage between the two. So Ambassador Karklans mentioned something to all of you called the CSTD, the Commission on Science and Technology for Development Working Group Report on Improvements for the IGF. That was approved by the UN General Assembly in 2012 as a result of a two-year working initiative under the auspices of the Commission on Science and Technology for Development. And for the first time, the CSTD undertook a multi-stakeholder working group, which was an intergovernmental process of 20 governments with five IGOs as observers and five plus five plus five, five technical community, five business community, and five civil society, who worked together to develop this recommendation for improvements to the IGF. Now, this recommendation came out of a critical period when, during the previous authorization extension at the UN, there were many, many concerns expressed by certain member states that the IGF was a talk shop, it was not creating outputs, it wasn't widely known. There were very few national and regional IGFs at the time. We had a funding challenge at that time because of the 5-year period. And so really what happened when the UN General Assembly approved the recommendations to the IGF that had come up organically developed, first of all, of their representatives that came from the community, and several of the government representatives on that working group were from the MAG or very actively engaged in the IGF. So there was not a complete vacuum of understanding and experience. But the thing to understand is that it is really, really, really important to begin to better understand how we are communicating into the rest of the world about what we're doing. So we agreed at the MAG, our interpretation of the call to action to increase the outputs and to do something concretely about a universally important theme, the MAG identified the theme policy options for connecting the next billion. The invitation to the community from the MAG was that anyone could contribute to developing the policy options. The national and regional IGFs on their own organically began to contribute. And so we actually have had a very strong contribution without a mandate, but on a voluntary basis, recognizing the invitation and stepping up to it. And I think that's something that's really important. And I particularly appreciated Mark Carvel's comments this morning that inviting us to propose a theme for next year, and the MAG chair, hoping we would do that today, ignored the fact that we are all bound by our own need to consult at the national level or the regional level about what our priorities are. But I just think the illustration of the interest in contributing into the intersessional work was pretty remarkable. And let me turn this to you and Ellen, Mark.
Thanks, Marilyn. In fact, there were 10 national initiatives that contributed to the Connecting the Next Billion initiative, and 5 regional initiatives that contributed. So at this point, I'd like to call on those initiatives that did contribute to come forward and speak for a few minutes about the process and the content of what they developed. Maybe starting with, I think Zimbabwe is in the room. I think that would be a good place to start.
She's gone.
I don't know if Zimbabwe is still here.
No.
Had to leave.
No. Maybe we can go to.
Oh, there we go.
There you are.
There you are.
It's difficult to start. You want me to? Sorry.
If you could just give a 2 to 3 minute update on your submission to Connecting the Next Billion.
Right. The person who actually submitted was actually different from me. It was our secretariat, but I'll actually just give a very quick one. With us, we are still really evolving in as far as the setting up of the national backbone is concerned, but we are actually at a fairly advanced stage, I think, in terms of the connection of the national backbone, because obviously that is what premises the issue of connecting the next billion. We have got a situation where, in as far as our mobile is concerned, our mobile infrastructure is concerned, is actually been improving, increasing, quite significantly over the last few years. We have a connectivity which is fairly high. We are premising our connections around that infrastructure which has actually been developed. I would need to actually go ahead and look at the actual submission which we actually made for me to make sure that my responses are actually tallying with what was actually submitted. But otherwise, that's the premise of what we have in the country at the moment.
I think it was pretty impressive. I think it was great you started at the end of the alphabet instead of the beginning, which is what usually happens. But I think it was pretty impressive that for a brand new national IGF that you you stepped up to making a submission. So congratulations on that.
Thank you. I think there's a few people who have to run out of the room very soon, including two that actually submitted a contribution, Mary and Sandra.
And Manu, I think, has to leave as well.
Right. Actually, we've got four or five people. Arm wrestle for the mic. No, maybe we can go with Mary first.
Is the mic? The mic?
Okay, thank you very much. We answered most of the questions that was most of the questions submitted forwarded to us. How would you define the issue of connecting the next billion? And we looked at, we said that there are people, you know, we are under the, our environment is the mobile environment. And so many people are online through the mobile devices. And but there are a lot that are not, because not all the people are using smart mobile devices. So we still have to get others coming into the internet space. So and how you observed any regional or national specific regarding connectivity? We are working on our broadband. Our broadband roadmap is there, and we are hoping that the broadband roadmap, when it's on, that would have a lot of connectivity, especially those in the rural area and the unconnected people. Those are the ones that we are looking at. And existing policies, we have policies, and we have what we call smart cities, smart states, and we also have what we call the government policy on ICT that would help us get 50% broadband by 2017. So, we also are looking at the agencies that are involved. We have the National Communications Commission and the National Information Technology Development Agency, and some of the funds, the Universal Access Provisioning Fund, that are available to be able to get to the unconnected and unreached areas. So we are doing that. We have school access as well. We have what we call knowledge access centers, and we are trying to reach villages. For instance, in 2015, my village had knowledge access center dropped about 20 computers with internet access and with e-learning. And so people are doing that. And those are the things we are doing. And we have the NICOMSAT trying to drop satellites to be able to reach the unreached. In your opinion, what worked well in developing the policies? There was consultation. So many people, the stakeholders were brought together, and we actually made input into it. What was the experience with implementation? And we had a challenge of right of way. Those that are given the backbone connectivity, they had challenge of right of way, and that's a big challenge for us. And double taxation is also a big challenge for us. Did you experience any unintended consequences of policy development intervention, good or bad? The introduction of the policy has exposed the fact that there is lack of human capital. We don't have the skill sets. So a lot of capacity building needs to be done to be able to get it going. And we also, the access. Where we have affordability, we don't have accessibility. When we have accessibility, we don't have affordability. So those are things that we also find that there are challenges to us. can you think of unresolved issues? We said there is issue with respect to multiple taxation is not resolved, right of way not resolved. Those are the things that are list proposed steps for further multi-stakeholder dialogue. We'll continue with our IGF and we'll also contribute. What we do at the end of the year, we give our report to the government, and some of them they have really accepted. Thank you. I think I'm speaking too long, so I should stop.
Okay. It's great. Thank you, Mary.
All right.
I'd actually like to recognize Manu Bhardwaj from the State Department, and I'd call on him to speak about their contribution to the Connecting the Next Billion.
Thank you. Manu Bhardwaj. For this year's IGF USA, Connecting the Next Billion featured very prominently on the agenda. We invited our Undersecretary of State to deliver closing remarks, and in those remarks, we underscored how it's a foreign policy priority of the United States to redouble development efforts to connect the next billions online, and that in that regard, we're looking forward to partnering with all interested stakeholders, development agencies, multilateral development banks, to find ways to foster, whether it's innovative technological solutions, public-private partnerships, policy reforms, financing, funds, grants, to help key emerging markets, developing countries, with some of the questions that they're facing and how they connect the rest of their population. I'm very proud to say that, you know, at the IGF USA and based on our consultations there, which included, of course, the closing session and then also the plenary that followed with a number of industry and NGOs and others on how we should best, as the U.S. stakeholder community, partner and help other countries in thinking about international connectivity. After all those consultations that we had at the IGF USA, we decided, and we just recently launched, a major new diplomatic effort called Global Connect. It was launched a month ago, and it shows, I think this shows the critical role that the IGF has in international internet policy making, that we basically decided to move forward with our major initiative that was also previewed by the Secretary of State. Global Connect is a new effort and is supported by a number of folks in the government and industry where. And it's basically recognizing that we have a shared responsibility to try to bring 1.5 billion people online by 2020. This was an international metric that we all agreed to at the ITU Plenipotentiary. And through Global Connect, we hope to give effect to our universal desire to see more ICT technologies available to everyone in the world. We are partnering with the multilateral development banks, particularly the World Bank, to think about how to prioritize digital access. We have increased the funding in our own U.S. development organizations, USAID, Millennium Challenge Corporation, Overseas Private Investment Corporation, to do more in terms of broadband access and digital. We are also trying to showcase and encourage some of the innovative industry solutions to provide connectivity to remote areas. Some of it you can probably see in the tent outside that we have here. But you know, we're very excited about this new effort, and we're looking forward to continuing the conversations here in Brazil about next steps for Global Connect and using the IGF as a preeminent venue for fostering these types of discussions with all stakeholders. Thank you.
Thank you, Manu. It's actually a very interesting initiative. I've been on the site and did some digging into it, and it's actually quite fascinating to see almost a multi-stakeholder, so many parties involved in development in the digital age. It's quite fascinating. Thank you. Sandra.
Thank you. The topic of connecting the next billion came in when the Eurodig programming process was already underway, but we were lucky enough to put it into the agenda, and it was dedicated a whole workshop, which was under the lead of the Council of Europe. Lee Hibbert is in the room, and co-supported by the CEDIC people and also by the European Commission. And for the content part, I would like to hand over to Lee, because he has to leave the room soon, because he was leading that workshop.
Thank you, Sandra. Hello, everybody. Just to say that I'll also be in the main session this afternoon on policy options. I'll actually be moderating part of the session, so I hope to see you there. And if you know, can come to the front, I will try to bring you into that discussion. We had a good discussion in the Eurodig. It's quite clear that there's a very high level of broadband access in Europe. It seems over 400 million users have access to the internet. saying that, there are still some discrepancies about different parts of the population. We spoke about differences between rural and urban access, the aging population. We discussed differences between, questions of skills became quite a good discussion. The fact is, access is one thing, but access to what, according to what skill set? And there are some issues regarding the amount of skills. And of course, we talked about the logical layer, the physical infrastructure layer, the differences about how to get the infrastructure going, the rollout of broadband. There are already strategies at the European Union level, which are moving forward, which are encouraging questions of access. But of course, not one size fits all regarding how to do it, public-private partnerships, etc. So there's also a local flavour which has to be respected. It can't be driven from a top-down approach. It was quite clear that it's not a top-down approach. It's definitely a mixed approach. It was a good discussion, and I think we're still learning on how to make access really a reality in some countries. There were some good examples of lessons learned. For example, in Slovenia and then in Latvia. Latvia spoke about, without wishing to disturb competition, they were rolling out more public access points. And in doing so, they saw that was affecting, that's reducing the demand for 3G, mobile 3G. So there is a correlation there, or could be said, between public access points and access via mobile. So there are some interesting examples of how, different actions by the government and access to, just a normal subscription can affect how you access the internet. So I hope to see you all in the room, in the main hall this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee. Just to add from my point of view, we just made a very short survey among all European national IGFs, and I was asking for the three hot topics which has been discussed over the year. To be frank, it was not on the hot topics of the national agendas, connecting and expillion. So I think that was a topic to be discussed on a regional level, or maybe on a sub-regional, and also on the global level. But for the national agendas, this was not on the hot topics. It was said before in this room, on national level, you rather discuss concrete concerns on or issues. Thank you.
Thank you. The discussion on connecting to what I find is a fascinating one, and we had that discussion in Canada as well. We spent a fair amount of time defining access versus defining meaningful access. And meaningful access has a very different connotation than does just the binary, are you connected to the internet or are you not? So I think that's very interesting. Is there anyone else in the room from a national or regional initiative? Yes, please.
Good morning. My name is Julian Casas Buenas. I work as director of Colnodo in Colombia. And we had the opportunity of participating in the national IGF meeting at the end of September, and also to contribute to the document of policy options for connecting the next billion. And we had the opportunity to collect all the inputs from our regional meeting. We have a couple of sessions that were oriented in reduce poverty through the use of ICTs. So our report was very much taking all these inputs. The ones that I want to highlight are referred to facilitate the extension of access in rural areas of the municipalities, for example, through the deployment of wireless community networks that can be operated by the community, and the internet can be provided by broadband links with those municipalities. We see opportunities in countries like Colombia, were digital agendas that favor the promotion of the subject at national levels, ICT appropriation needs with differentiated approaches for women, people with disabilities. It is also important to offer more advanced skills. Current and relevant initiatives of public access to ICTs, like in Colombia, it's called Puntos Vive Digital, and development of ICTs training in a more advanced and than basic digital literacy training. Also, be content producers with new skills and in our own and local language that promote cultural diversity, and the penetration of mobile telephony to extend access in areas that is not yet covered. And we also highlight the importance of sharing experiences with civil society organization in methodologies of appropriation in telecenters. And in the case of Colombia, we exchange these experiences that show that connectivity policies should be accompanied by a component of ICT appropriation in order to take advantage of this infrastructure more efficiently. That demonstrates that work with multiple stakeholders can bring these initiatives to have more success. And where the points that multi-stakeholder cooperation it's needed, we during the national meeting we get into these points: the recognition that financial resources are limited and the multi-stakeholder cooperation is needed to implement projects relevant to connecting the next billion, that includes the production of local content relevant to local communities and strategies that use ICTs to solve these local problems. The recognition of gender gaps, generational and ethnic, and in rural contexts and urban. The recognition of who we are as internet users, also the production of differentiated statistics and impact analysis, especially on the issue of mobile internet access geographically differentiated. Digital agendas that recognize that there are diverse strategies and that the massive digital literacy initiatives take into account the social gaps, and the recognition of the reasons for the exclusion. And finally, appropriation of ICT strategies that address the needs and characteristics of women and disabled and elderly. Regarding the list of proposed steps for further multi-stakeholder dialogue and actions, we believe that multi-stakeholder actions are needed to extend the impact of ICTs in reducing the extreme poverty in countries like Colombia, participate in spaces like the Internet Governance Forum at local, regional, and global level that support the implementation of policies that contribute to the stability of Internet as an agent for development and reduction of the digital divide. The ICT appropriation component linked to access is very important to increase the impact of government initiatives and reduce the digital divide. Working together to promote the production of software and local contents with a social focus, improvement of education through the use of ICTs, facilitation of access to online financial services to reduce the digital divide. And it's key to continue and encourage public internet access strategies and not neglect them for the opportunities posed by mobile internet access, because these spaces are an opportunity for vulnerable communities linked to the information society. Work together to expand access in rural areas and communities not connected, promoting, among others, the community wireless networks, and to connect schools and libraries to broadband. Reduce or eliminate taxes related to internet access and devices needed to deploy infrastructure. And work to reduce gender gaps and ICTs. That was like the points that we want to share with you as highlights of the discussions. And a final comment we have regarding the discussions in WISIS Plus 10, have to mention that we had the opportunity to make comments from the Colombian Internet Governance Group. The government shared the document, the zero draft, with us. And as a group of Colombian Internet Governance Group, we were able to make our inputs as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go to Brazil in the front row. I believe there's a mic right behind you.
Excellent. Yeah, just a brief report. Although Brazilian national IGF did not submit a contribution to the connecting next billion effort, this is of course a subject of very large importance in Brazil due to the size of the country, the poverty we still have, the digital divide we still have among different groups in the society, different regions in the country. So we have already organized 5 editions of the national IGF, and universality and digital inclusion are always one of the main subjects, and always subject of one of the breakout sessions we organize. And we have the tradition to always have outcomes from the national IGFs. So we always propose recommendations in a bottom-up way. The different breakout sessions prepare recommendations that are then reported to the final plenary and then approved by the final plenary. And these recommendations are, in many cases, proposed policy, public policies, and recommendations are sent to different ministries, also to the CGI, BR, if appropriate. So we have this tradition in Brazil, and this subject is always present in our discussions.
Excellent. Excellent. Thank you. Actually, we'll go to third row. McCain? So if we could get a mic back there, and then front row.
And then come back over here.
Yeah, and then we'll
go. Okay, back. Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. My name is Makan Fai, Secretariat of the African IGF. Just like to give a brief report on the connecting the next billion session we organized in Addis in September. We had the following 6 recommendations. Connecting the next billion should be viewed as a program project by countries and stakeholders, and as such should be approached using the program project best practices and methodologies. And in this context, the ministries of communications and IT should review their ICT and broadband policy plans through enhanced multi-stakeholder cooperation, because we believe that this should not be done only by government or by the private sector, but the civil society and technical community should also be involved. There is also a need to have effective monitoring and evaluation of the programs using online real-time portal reportage. The open data model, local content development, e-learning initiative, and others should also be used to boost the demand, because we believe that doing the pipes only will not serve purpose, and we should have the demand also. That's why the content is very important. And the universal service provision funds also should be used, because we have regulators collecting a lot of money, and this should be used to engender infrastructure into the underserved areas and enable high-end access and affordability. The power grid capacity also should be boosted to be able to make sure that we have power everywhere to be able to bring in about the internet. Finally, the African Union was requested to explore the creation of a continental common toll-free internet platform in cooperation with the telecommunications agencies and other stakeholders to preserve the identity and unique cultural heritage of Africa. Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
Thank you. Alberto Perez from IGF Spain and Red.ts. Unfortunately, in our case, we could not submit a position in this very relevant topic, mainly due to the fact that there's no full coordination between how the agenda for this meeting is made and an hour that has different timing. So we could not deal with it, but since we were working for this session, we have received several input from some of the stakeholders, both public and private, highlighting that in the case of IGF Spain, we can have a coordinated approach for some areas that have to be covered, in which we share the same language and a lot of cultural features with those areas. So we're in a good position to increase local content and to exchange best practice without the barrier of language. So I wanted to highlight how this global IGF will feed back into our next sessions, and also how it can be relevant that we cooperate among different national initiatives where we see there are specific advantages for this cooperation. So I've been hearing with a lot of interest to all that has been said by our Colombian colleague, and we should outreach and get to be more in contact with other Latin American IGFs and see if we can involve common shareholders, because there are, for example, cooperation agencies or international companies that are active in both sides of the Atlantic, and that we could try to set up some actions covering this area. So this could be good use of cooperation among national IGFs, so we will try to look in this direction. Thank you.
Excellent idea. We have two more comments, I think, and after that we'll move to the next item on the agenda, but Afghanistan first and next.
Thank you very much. My name is Omar Ansari. I'm an entrepreneur based in Kabul, Afghanistan. We have some specific challenges. They're different than other countries. I've shared this in the meeting yesterday, a workshop. 1 Mbps internet costs $300 in Afghanistan. It's less than a dollar in Japan. And Japan is a very rich country. Afghanistan is the poorest country. This, I think, is one of the greatest problems we need to address. There could be similar countries like Afghanistan, the least developed countries, who might have problems like this. If we're thinking about connecting the next billion, and Afghanistan being a country of 30 million people, we need to be at the core of the agenda, because it's impossible for us to connect the 30 million Afghans to internet when the cost is $300. It's extremely unaffordable even for businesses to buy such internet. The other issue we are facing is with the local contents. We're a non-English speaking country. People do not understand the technology which is available in English or any other language, which the locals do not speak. We need to localize apps and content boards so people can see the benefits of connecting to the internet. Even if it's $10 per Mbps, they need to see there are some benefits and they would then embrace it. The third problem we're facing is with the policies and regulatory environment. Awareness creation. We should be able to create an awareness locally in Afghanistan among the population. They're using Facebook. Some providers would do like free Facebook in their mobile phones. But Facebook is not all the internet. It's a good tool for us to connect with each other, create awareness on different social and political issues, but still we need more of the internet to be available to our citizens in Afghanistan. We are thinking of two initiatives in Afghanistan. One is the national IGF and the other is our regional IGF, which would be a Central South Asian IGF, so that we can connect with the rest of the region and be part of the regional programs, initiatives, and an active participant of the global development in Afghanistan. That's where we need your support, advice, we need speakers, we need advisors, we need supporters. So I'm just requesting that. If you have time later, let's discuss about that.
Excellent. Thank you. The gentleman from Asia Pacific in the back there.
Edmund Chung from Asia Pacific Regional IGF. I guess following up from what was just said, I guess the APR IGF, it is a big, it is connecting the next billion is one of the biggest topic for us. In fact, we believe in including Afghanistan, that the next billion is likely coming, majority of that is likely coming from the Asia Pacific region. If you look at India, China, Afghanistan, and many of the areas in Asia Pacific. So this year especially, we did have a submission to the intersessional, which leads into the next billion discussion. And in terms of the process, this year we did a pretty, a new trial. We actually created a synthesis document that is kind of as an output from the APR IGF. This is one of the first time, and hopefully in the future we will create that too. And just looking at the document itself, it's obviously posted publicly, and it's also part of the input itself. There's 12 specific points on synthesizing the discussions from the region. Out of the 12 points, actually three of them specifically talks about bringing next billion online. And also the overarching note is talking about the next billion people coming online, and especially a comparative analysis of what was done before. The gentleman mentioned about the cost, and one of the key aspects is to have affordable accessibility. But the other part, which is substantive, I think is what many others have mentioned as well, and we summarized it as digital literacy. And we also follow up on that is many talked about the language, local content, local language issues. We also identified that in multiple sessions. In fact, there were five workshops altogether that were talking about different aspects of this, including the mobile side, including the content side, including the gender, bridging the gender divide, but also on identifiers, internationalized email addresses, internationalized domain names, and the acceptance of that in the internet, both technically and in terms of awareness. So this is and that and one interesting thing that was also highlighted is that also the need for non-textual content. We're talking about reaching out to the next billion. Non-textual content may be very important because videos or images are much easier to convey sort of information in many ways, especially graphs or that's infographics and those type of items and videos, of course. And then another item that is very important and also included in the synthesis document is open access and spectrum, open spectrum for Wi-Fi and other types of access, which leads into the issue of having spectrum licenses and a more open environment for spectrum licenses and those kind of things. So I think those are some of the more substantive or I guess highlights from the input. Again, I point to the synthesis document, which we're quite proud of that we were able to put it together. And in terms of that process, what happened was that all the workshops that were received was kind of funneled into the synthesis document before the APRIGF event actually happened. At the APRIGF, every day over the four-day period, we had town hall meetings to talk about the texts and also talk about the substantive items onto the synthesis document. Coming out of the event, actually, there was a one-month period where we collected comments online until it was finally finalized, which is the synthesis document that was then submitted as input into the intersessional. So that's this is definitely a very big topic for Asia Pacific, and I think we did hopefully we have substantive input into the process, but also the sharing of learning and comparative studies I think is going to be very important for this for our region to move forward and actually connect the next billion to the internet. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. I think we're going to wrap this up after one more comment.
I was just going to comment. I'm Shane with IGF USA, and somewhat like the MAG, we had the challenge of having so many people that wanted to participate, choosing, to stay on track. And it's very interesting to hear, the challenges that the other IGFs are having. And as the just proximity to New York, we would certainly be happy to help carry these messages as we go into December with the WSIS Plus 10.
Very good, thank you. I think we'll conclude our discussion on connecting the next billion there. And I'll turn it over to my colleague, Ellen, to lead the next session.
Thanks, Mark. So the next agenda item is looking at reflecting views into the IGF processes and reflecting from the IGF international and regional initiative processes. So we're interested in having thoughts about also reflections about what you've done and also thoughts about going forward and how we might improve that, thinking about preparation, the event itself, and follow-up as well for both your own event and how it relates to this as to the IGF. I know this is an area personally for NetHui that we certainly look to the IGF in the process as we're doing our own process, but we also still find challenges in terms of reflecting views here through at the IGF. For us, for example, one of the issues is it's a long way to travel and getting people here to participate and engage in the IGF itself and make sure that the sort of messages and content comes through is a real challenge for us. So we're very interested to hear ideas about reflections on your experience as well as thoughts for the future. Laura, do we have a mic for up the front? Yeah, thank you, Anya.
Thanks. Laura Hutchison from the UK IGF nominate for the record. I wanted to pick up on Mark's suggestion that he made in his opening remarks. I think the idea of reaching out to regional national IGFs for topics it absolutely makes sense. And we have a network where we have a lot of in-depth discussions. So I think there's a network that could be, usefully relied on. Also, from our experience of running a workshop, the requirements for the panel to be sort of global and balanced, which absolutely makes sense. But the struggle from our side is I don't necessarily have the contacts to know who would be an expert on a particular topic from a region that isn't my own. So if the workshops were organised on a topic basis, so say if, I don't know, six regional nationals suggested particular topics, they could then work on a workshop, would then make sense that you've already got global representation on a panel. Also, Ellen's just mentioned now about travel restrictions and difficulty in travelling. I don't know if there's any opportunity to maybe use the regional national network for remote hubs or online hubs, as I think we're meant to call them, to make sure that there's a network of integration from the IGF to reach back out to the regional nationals. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Laura. Those are some very practical ideas, for sure. Yes, gentlemen over there.
Thank you. My name is Makan Fai, the Secretariat of the African IGF. Our planning took us 5 months from planning to implementation. And for the structure, we had an organizing committee of 10 members coming from government, civil society, private sector, technical community, and international organizations. The experts to run the meeting were chosen, suggested by organizing committee members. And also when we put up the program on the website, some people asked if they could also be a panelist. So we checked and as much as there was place to accommodate experts who were not on the preliminary list, we took them. We had a meeting on 3 days. 1 day for pre-conference meetings, which were organized by organizations who had a stake on IGF. And those pre-conference meetings were essentially done to prepare the main meetings, which will be spanning into 2 days. We had 14 plenary sessions, and all the sub-teams of the global IGF was reviewed and discussed in the ADIS meeting. On funding, we have challenges in funding. Some people were self-sponsored, but the main funding came from the Economic Commission for Africa, that is the UN Regional Commission, the African Union, which was the host of the meeting. You had also sponsors from international organizations and NGOs, especially APC, ICANN, ISOC, AFRINIC, and UNESCO. The meeting was conducted in two languages, English and French. To enable simultaneous interpretation to enable various language groups to take part. And the African IGF was preceded this year by the African School on Internet Governance, which was organized by APC and the NEPAD agency, where that enabled us, in fact, to have a good gender balance during the meeting, because the African School of Internet Governance had brought a lot of female participants. So that is, in a nutshell, what I had to say for the time being. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing that. It's interesting the sub-themes were included. Could I just ask, focusing on the links with the IGF, how do you have any suggestions for your IGF initiative engaging with the IGF as a whole?
Yes. In fact, I always participate in the MAG meetings, not as a MAG member, but as an international organization, a UN organization. And in this connection, we take part in the discussion in forming the MAG main team, the IGF main team and the sub-teams also, because we are part of the discussion list, and several of African stakeholders also are members of the MAG and are part of the discussion list we have set up. So I've set up a discussion list where we always circulate what is decided and discussed at the MAG, so that we get our African views and we input collectively to the into the MAG decisions. That's why every year we decide to review all the MAG sub-teams in our meetings before coming to going to the global level, so that we can have input at the African level. Like the Connecting the Next Billion, we had issues on cybersecurity, we had issues on internet rights. So we have a report on all the sub-teams which are discussed here today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think also some of your sharing about your event, I just wanted to clarify that we do have the survey on the national and regional IGF initiatives that was collected, that where it's a collection of many of the details you shared, and that we will be doing that presentation and having a chance to have a discussion about that probably after this agenda item.
In the survey, it's Marilyn speaking, in the survey many of you made specific comments, but I just want to mention again that in some ad hoc gatherings when some of us have been present, we've also talked about, I'm going to use a term that is emerging around the IG space, but the idea of creating more of an observatory focused on the national and regional IGFs at the Secretariat, similar to what's being done with the Diplo Foundation on hot topics on internet governance, where you know, we would design an approach that would be available on the Secretariat space, so it's neutral space, but it would be a way for us, you know, come up with some of the areas where we think sharing of information, whether it's sharing of a list of experts in an area, expert speakers in an area, or other kinds of information that would begin to build the, I do not mean to use the word best practices here, but maybe case examples of things that are being done. A number of the, and I think there's a mix, what I'm hearing is a mix of things that might be standardized on the process and procedure side to offload a new initiative. So I'm going to give you an example. You're required to track multi-stakeholder participation and report on it in your report. You should also be tracking gender and report on it in your report. But unless you capture that information automatically in your registration process, it becomes onerous to try to for you to gather it and to backtrack and find it. So, you know, thinking about the kinds of things that you might want to put forward as recommendations, where something could be, I use the term lightly, you know, a template, a standard, a downloadable registration package, things of that nature that we might look to the Secretariat to help to put together and make available, versus an observatory where people could share content, information, they could share examples of a workshop they did in one area that they think would be applicable to a sister initiative. When we did scenario stories in the United States, and Shane was here and was very active in that, we did scenario stories in the United States. I learned about the use of scenario stories by coming to the Netherlands and participating in a conference that, an initiative that had been sponsored by the Dutch government took it to the IGF USA, and then we took it to Russia. But there was no real way to, and then we actually did a roundtable in Ghana, in Kenya, where several of the national and regional IGFs came and participated. But we have no place to store that information. And I just use that as an example to say, you know, perhaps we should be thinking, Laura, about, you know, reflecting and then reflecting on process and procedures, one thing, but then also reflecting in themes, issues, and thinking about a space that is sort of designed, if I could say this, by inputs from the national and regional coordinators. Then the final thing I wanted to say is we had decided, there was an idea that we would do a booth at this IGF and use it as a way to create more visibility and to, and we missed that, but we did talk about the idea of at this meeting forming a group, a small group that might be interested in carrying forward on planning for a booth for IGF 2016. But perhaps we should also be thinking about planning for visibility for the national and regional IGFs in a separate meeting that is held always at the MAG consultations. And perhaps it's, you know, we do it in a way that we make sure that you have a dedicated time. Many of some of you are MAG members, others need to be in those consultations, as McCain was saying, but maybe we go through some ideas of saying, okay, and we're going to do it, by the way, as much as possible at a time that's reasonable for remote participation for those that are not there.
Thank you, Marilyn, and I think it was wonderful to hear Tangutai's remarks reflect the importance that he sees in that. And I think, you know, one thing, this agenda item, we're looking at the IGF processes, you know, and how we reflect back and forth with initiatives, but this relationship between us as initiatives and the opportunity that presents and best practice and sharing is really important. We have another speaker at the back. Do you have a microphone? No.
Yes, I do. Well, I'm Ana Neves. I'm from Portugal. I'm from the governmental side, and I would like to share here with you. Well, I think a new idea about engagement. Well, it's very difficult for us to engage our stakeholders in Portugal. Whenever we talk about internet governance, well, nobody understands us. So we have these sessions about cybersecurity, digital inclusion, but all in all, internet governance as a whole, they cannot perceive that. So I think it would be very interesting if each stakeholder, I mean, if business, civil society, the technical community, from the IGF community that are very active here, if they could engage with their peers, for instance, in Portugal, to make them aware of what their concerns are and why they are so engaged in internet governance. So if, for instance, APC could engage with the civil society in Portugal to make them understand why they are here, why they are so so concerned, or why they are so excited about some ideas, movements, processes. I think it will be so so good because they speak the same language. They are the peers, and the same occurs with the businesses and the technical community. So here in Portugal, this initiative is really led by the government. Unfortunately, it's top down. I would love it to be a bottom up, but I think that in this way, I think it's a new way to see things. And this community that we have here, that is so rich, I think it could be really useful for the national and regional initiatives. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We need a mic up the front. There we go. Thanks.
Yeah, hi, I'm David Viorst. I help to organize the IGF USA. A few observations about our experiences that might be useful. We have a lot of natural advantages that we almost take for granted. For example, our interface with the MAG, Marilyn is the founder and the self-titled chief catalyst, Mike Nelson is very active. And there's about, there's dozens of other people that just have such a deep institutional knowledge that finding experts doesn't even come up, but we should maybe list that and share that and contribute that to a resource hub. We send out a general survey at the beginning of our planning process to the community writ large. We have a steering committee and we have open meetings that anybody's invited to. The challenge is always kind of taking democratic inputs and filtering them into a working process. We're still learning and we're getting there. One of our shortcomings, I think, we take a lot of criticism because it's really, I wouldn't say it's Washington, D.C. centric, and I think the criticisms aren't completely justified, but it occurs in Washington, D.C. We really need to have satellite participation from other locations in the United States, and we'll work on that. One of the things that we do that might be applicable or might be able to expand out on or work forward from is at the end closing ceremony of the IGF USA, we have each panel and session organizer present key takeaways. I think if we had key takeaways from all of the regional and national initiatives at the global IGF, it would kind of give, it would integrate better, it would give everybody a better sense, an actual experience, not just of the process, but of the content of what people are talking about at the other ones. And then there's other creative ideas we'd like to pursue down the road once we get more stable. We'd like to make video highlights of key takeaways and share those globally. And we would like to, we take our deep integration into the MAG for granted. We would like to share our initiative with other initiatives in any way possible.
Thank you very much. That's some very practical, good thoughts. Any other comments about the links between the IGF and initiatives? Yes, in the middle at the back. We get a mic back there.
Hi, Julian Casas Buenas from Colombia. Well, I think that for us this year, I can see a better interaction among the regional and national processes. I think that being able to be in this kind of sessions, it's a sign that I appreciate, and also promote the participation through the surveys in different topics to find out how different regions and national are addressing these issues. It's a good. I think it's a good exercise. So also it's important for national or regional IGFs to see that their inputs are taken into consideration for the global discussions. So if we are able to share these results from the national and regional to be placed here, that's very positive. It's a challenge to improve these inputs from local and regional discussions into the global IGF, but I think that having these spaces, it's a step forward.
Thank you.
It's Marilyn speaking. So I'm going to announce a failure to deliver something that I think would have been really, really useful. And it was neither my fault nor Mark's fault. I came up with the idea of a social networking event or coffee, and Mark offered to sponsor it, and then we were unable to make it happen. But I don't want to lose track of that, because I think that something, which was why I wanted you to have an open square, so that you would become more familiar with each other. I tend to know most of the national and regional coordinators by face, and there's a number of reasons for that. I cheat because I meet some of the representatives like Arnold and Mark and Anna at ICANN meetings, and so, you know, I get to extrapolate, or I meet them at a WSIS meeting or a CSTD meeting. But I think one thing that we might do, and I'm looking at the secretariat and hoping they don't cringe, I think we really ought to come up with not just our booth plan for next year, where in order to do a booth, and I'm going to propose that we think about a double booth, we're going to have to staff it, we're going to have materials in it. So here's something I want you to think about. Over the lunch time slot, the IGF Support Association is meeting, and I see Edmund here as well. Edmund and I are both on the executive committee of the IGFSA, and part of the mission of the IGF Support Association is to raise funds to support the secretariat, but also the national and regional IGFs. And this year, although we just got started last year, we just got incorporated, we gave five financial sponsorships of $3,500 to five regional IGFs, and we gave 15 $2,000 USD grants to of sponsorship to national IGFs. In our plan for next year is the ability to provide individual funding. We both didn't raise the funds, but we didn't have a process. So one of the things that occurs to me coming out of the survey is the challenge that particularly the national IGFs from developing countries or those that are in have decided to locate their country in some really difficult to reach place, Laura, I'm sure that was like a state decision, right? That perhaps a proposal to the IGFSA that in addition to the sponsorship of the event, that there should be a small travel fund as well, so that each of the national IGFs from developing countries could have a designated attendee. And I think, you know, we then need to begin to make sure that we are creating the identity, that when we are in the meetings, that we know each other's faces. So let's start thinking about how we do that. So I have one final thing for you to think about. I chair the outreach and communications work at the IGFSA, and I'd like you to help me think about a four-page meet the national and regional IGFs, and I'd like to try to do that in the next 2 weeks so that it could be provided in time for the New York high-level event. And I have an idea in mind which will not take a lot of work from you, but it will take a little bit of work, so we could have a a world map and then little synthesis of what is going on in each region about the national and regional IGFs. I think you would find it useful. I think the broader community would find it useful. I think we could use it at the UN, but I think it also would help you then to know who your colleagues are, perhaps in an adjacent country. I don't know if that's reflection, but I think if the rest of the 2,000 attendees here also had a piece of paper and something online in order to get to know you, that would also be helpful. So I just throw that out.
Thanks, Marilyn. I think, practical suggestions to divert, but one of the things we found really useful is having, you know, those little colored flags that you attach to your badge that you see at some conferences. They say newcomer or something like that, that we could have one at our stand, and then you know that you're people who are involved with the national or regional initiative, and you can say, oh, which one are you involved with? I'm aware we only have 30-something minutes left, so... Oh, we have a remote participant to participate. We have that, and then we have one more in this, two more in this session, and then we'll move on to the next item. Remote participant, please.
Yes, thank you, Chair. We have a comment from Nikuru E that says, government engagement. Most of the internet governance-related events I have attended always speaks of government capture, which often comes out as offensive. In multi-stakeholder model and in the definition of internet governance, government is considered one of the stakeholders. In Africa, for instance, government is often the highest spender and also the implementer of policies. So if the issue of capture is addressed and not attributed often to government, perhaps there will be more involvement and possible buy-in. ITU happens to often to offer them this, which is why there is a greater participation and involvement.
All right, thank you for that comment. I think one of the strengths we've heard here is we have quite a lot of government involved with the initiatives, which is great to see. So as I said, we will wrap up this item and suggest we move on to the survey before doing closing, but we have two final comments. So could we get a mic to the gentleman from the Netherlands? There you go. Please.
Thank you, Ellen. Does it work? Yeah. All right. Thank you, Ellen. My name is Arnold van Rijn. Arnold van Rijn from the Netherlands government. Well, you, for the transcript, it's spelled Arnold van Rijn. My last name is Van Rijn. Difficult name, but it sounds like the River Rhine. Thank you. Well, I would like to share with you very shortly some information about how we prepare, how we, the Netherlands IGF, prepare ourselves for the IGF and how we do our work or link our work with the initiatives. We are organizing the IGF. We, that is the Dutch government, in conjunction with the CCTLD, the Dutch CCTLD, called SIDN for .nl, and the national platform for the information society called ECP. So this is truly an example of public-private partnership. It is funded by the Dutch government as well as SIDN, the Dutch CCTLD registry. Our work starts when we go back. We will have a meeting in February, debriefing what we learned from the IGF. How did we do our work ourselves? What could be improved? What could be the themes for the next IGF? This meeting will be held in February, and then after that we will reach out to our stakeholders to get their involvement. We will organize a young IGF where youngsters can say what they want. We had a very truly wonderful experience with such a young audience, and they came up this year with 10 recommendations, which we took with us to the IGF in Brazil. Then we will have our meeting before the global IGF. I would stress to the other national IGFs, I see sometimes they have their meetings after the global IGF, to have that one before the IGF, to get truly a well-prepared meeting. This year, it was a special year, so we thought we will have had a special meeting of our national IGF. And we had, as I explained earlier before, some hot topics like Internet of Things, like privacy as innovation, but also some new funny intermezzos to sparkle the debate and to not be too serious. One of them was a test with a mind drone, how to lift a drone with your brains. We had an example during our global cyberspace conference in April this year, where it was a truly success, where FinSurf lifted indeed a drone. And another funny intermezzo was a data auction, We asked the people in the room, how much information, personal information would you like to give away on the internet? Your personal information, like your banking account, your PIN code, whatever. The winner got a smartwatch, which will get tracked on what you're doing every day. So it was really a success. This is in short what our experience was. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Sylvia will be the last for this agenda item.
Sylvia Cadena from APNIC. I help with a little bit with APR, IGF, MSG, and volunteered and failed terribly to help with the survey this year. I just wanted to make a couple of comments regarding this session and the operational issues around this regional and national IGFs for next year, next sessions for next year. And I really think that it takes a lot of time to get ideas like the pins for badges or having a booth actually to work and happen. So I would really encourage this group to try to be a little bit more practical on what operational decisions can be made and what the a committee that can be put forward to make these ideas a reality. Organizing a booth is not that complicated, actually. So it is just a question of who sends the request to the IGF secretariat on time, and then organize a roster to have people manning the booth during those days. So it should not be impossible to organize, or a coffee for people to gather or address the issues around the survey. So I really think there are many operational questions that are making this collaboration really hard, and I really encourage this group to take the operational bits a little bit more seriously. Thank you.
Thank you, Sylvia. I've promised Mary a very quick last word.
Okay, just a suggestion. With what we're doing now, I think by the time we're coming for the next IGF, there should be a sort of summary of what others have done, and we'll bring it up as part of the publication. I don't know whether it's possible or not. Then in our own case, we do the youth IGF, and our youth IGF is mainly hands-on. First time, we taught them how to, you know, what they can gain from the internet. Second, it was getting, last year, 2015, it was entrepreneurship. There were people, those that have succeeded in doing e-commerce, e-business, e-job, anything that one succeeded in doing. And they were really very, very happy by the time we ended. So it was a practical thing for the youth. And then we asked them what they want for the IGF, what are their own submission. And at the end of the day, they made a report. So we do it the first day. The second day, we do our full IGF. And before we come into our IGF, we do a lot of consultation. We start early enough because we do a feedback when we are ending our IGF. So we have some ideas of what theme and what people want to discuss that will be of benefit for Nigeria. That's what we do. And even at the sub-regional level, that's what we do as well. So those are the things I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll wrap up there. But I just have to add personally, I would love to see the initiatives involved in feeding in more youth input. I know we've had a youth IGF event in New Zealand. It's wonderful to see the ISOC ambassadors here, but you often see it's mostly people from the host country in terms of young people, and I think there's real opportunity there for us to bring the voices and messages and some of the youth of the world to the IGF. So I'll hand off now back to Mark. And the group who will present the survey, and before we go on to wrap up and think about next steps.
I think we should bring Serena up to the front. She's going to be with us presenting the survey.
Yes, and Anya's going to come.
Anya, please.
I think Anya. Yes.
So, the four of us will be presenting the results of the survey Marilyn had mentioned earlier. I'm actually just going to start right in. We've only got 20, 25 minutes to go through it, so we'll get to it as quickly as we can. Marilyn's going to lead off with the with some of the context and methodology.
Thank you, Mark. The survey is actually a decision that you all took, those of you who participated in some earlier calls. And so I want you to think of this as perhaps a first step at a survey. It is gathering some information. We did not use professional help in either designing the survey or in analyzing the survey, but we have bigger plans next year because Edmund and I are going to raise enough money at the IGF Support Association to be able to use a little professional assistance in it and also to make it easier for you. But there's some important information in this survey, and I really want us to, you know, think of it as it is. It's, I guess, when I was in at AT&T Computer Systems, AT&T Labs would have called this our beta. We haven't even gotten to. I don't think it's an alpha, but it's not. It's not much more than that. Okay, I need to know how to advance this. Oh, turn it the right way. Okay, so I'm going to do two things very, very quickly. I'm going to talk about who was included in this, who wasn't, and how you fix that for the next round. And then so right now on the IGF website, there are 13 regional/sub-regional IGFs, and there are about 30 national IGFs. But a number of new IGFs were launched this year. And because some of you have not completed submitting your identifying information to the Secretariat, you may not have been included in this. I am only aware of this gap because IGFSA funded some new initiatives, and we didn't get surveys back from you. So don't think of this as a bad thing. Think of it as an opportunity. But I'm passing around right now a couple of pieces of paper I want you to look at and then return to me. And if the name of your national initiative is not included on this page, then just write it in and see me afterward. Our goal is to be as inclusive as possible, but you do have to contact the Secretariat, not somebody else, to get your initiative listed. You don't have to have completed your report, but you got to have your contact, the working website, email, et cetera. And it's really important. Now, let me just say that in spite of the fact that you all are extremely busy, we got 25 returned responses. We did have to kind of contact some of you 17 times, but we got 25 returned responses. That is phenomenal. So let me let you guys kick off on analyzing, explaining the content there.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Marilyn, for the introduction on the survey. We will just go right to it because we don't have much time left. I hope you can see.
Yeah,
no.
They can see it.
Well, that's a sort of. Okay, now it changes. Okay.
But I want this one?
Yeah. So we start with basically the profile of the respondents. As you hopefully can see in the chart, we had the majority of initiatives responding from Europe, then North America, Asia, Pacific, Africa, and South America. Basically, we had responses from all regions, both national and regional IGF initiatives. Not too many, but the responses were actually useful for the analysis, and you will see throughout the presentation. One of the questions in the survey was about the way in which initiatives are hosted, and we asked, actually, the initiatives were asked to respond on that. And we got quite a diversity of answers on this. Some initiatives indicated that they have the organizing group, which also acts as a host. There are also cases of initiatives who have a secretariat in place in addition to the organizing group, which basically deals with the program and these kind of programming issues. And where there is a secretariat, it is hosted by a governmental entity sometimes, other times by private sector entities such as the CCTLD registry. And there are also cases of initiatives who have an independent secretariat, as in not associated with a governmental or non-governmental entity. We had one example of a regional initiative who indicated that it is hosted by an intergovernmental organization. We had examples of initiatives hosted in government-private company partnerships. And we had also responses from initiatives saying that they have a host for the annual meeting, not for the organizational process as such. And this host is decided on a year-by-year basis after a public call. So again, it makes it quite clear that there is no one-size-fits-all model for the way in which initiatives are hosted. Now moving forward, there were a couple of questions about how initiatives are funded and how they are transparent with regards to the way in which they are funded. When it comes to the funding sources, initiatives were asked to indicate where they received their sponsorship, and as you can see in the chart, most of them have a combination of sources, both from the host of the annual meeting and voluntary financial contributions and in-kind support from both the sponsors and the annual meeting. And there are also cases of initiatives who actually indicated that most of their funding is done by the organization who hosts the annual meeting, so not really having additional sponsors in addition to that. Moving forward, there were some non-compulsory questions in the survey asking initiatives to kindly indicate the sources of their sponsorship in terms of the exact entities. And not all initiatives responded to this, but this helped us build this chart which says where the initiatives get their sponsorship. And as you can see, most of them are funded by non-for-profit, NGOs, international internet organization. Then governments also contribute to some initiatives, and then the rest from the private sector and academia as sponsors for the initiatives. And we also got some examples of in-kind support received by initiatives, like venue for the meeting, catering, hosting of online content, like the website of the initiative, web streaming, internet connection, remote participation platforms. All these were examples of in-kind support that some initiatives are receiving. Now moving forward, initiatives were asked to indicate whether they published their budget. And this was quite of a surprise for us, because as you also can see, 44% of the initiative indicated that they do not publish the budget. Maybe next year we can ask about the reason for that, because now no one actually answered to that question. So maybe we can make that compulsory and actually see what is the reason for that. The next question related to the one before was about publishing lists of the sources of financial sponsorship. And this is a bit different, because the majority of the initiative indicated that they do publish or intend to publish the list of sources, some with amounts, some without the amounts for each each sponsor, and 35% of the initiatives said that they do not publish this kind of information. And I will stop. Okay, one more. Another question was about the organizational structure, how the initiatives are organizing their planning process and who is basically leading this process. This chart might look a bit complicated, but I will try to go through it. 65% of responding initiatives indicated that they have a steering group or a committee which supervises more or less the planning process. And with regards to the dimension of this committee, this varies from initiative to initiative. We had some initiative with a small steering committee and some other initiative with quite large steering committee, like 100 persons or even more. The next type of organizational structure was the program committee, then a logistical committee, and we also had initiatives who indicated that they employ other organizational structures, such as contracted organizing support or consultant, advisor, technical support, or some other related things. But we also had examples of initiatives who indicated that they use a combination of organizational structures from the list we had in the survey. For example, there was one national initiative who has a steering group. They have also a program committee and a logistical committee, so three things in one initiative. And there is also an example of a regional initiative who has a secretariat dealing with the logistical program process, but when the program is built, this is built by the whole community in a bottom-up manner. So again, there is no one-size-fits-all model for the organizational structure, just a combination of entities. And I will pass it on to my colleague.
So one of the questions that was related to the organizational structure was for all the initiatives to reply to us whether they require a multi-stakeholder makeup of the organizational structure. And based on the collected responses, 87% of you said were affirmative, so said that you do require a multi-stakeholder makeup, while the 13% of you replied negative. When it comes about whether do your initiatives track the gender balance and do you support the youth in your organizational structures as well as persons with disabilities, 65% of you, oh, sorry, I'm not good in multitasking, will you? 65% of you said that you do track and you include women in organizational structure, while 35 of you said that you don't. When it comes about inclusion of youth in organizational structure, 55% of you were affirmative, while 48 of you said that you don't include them. And when it comes about persons with disabilities in organizational structure, this is a very important information for the secretariat to work on it during the next year, because 83% of you were negative. That's a huge number. So that's something that we will all probably work on it after this IGF. When it comes about the time that you need for your planning phase, most of you said that you take more than 6 months to plan your event, 43% of you. Eight of you needed not more than 6 months, so 35% of you, while we had the smallest percentage taking 3 to 4 months. Only one initiative gave that response. So while you are planning your initiatives, we were wondering whether do you do different kinds of consultations when planning, and 87% of you said that you do, which is a good number for us. The 13% said that you, the 13%, right, I can't say that they were negative, but when we were analyzing the survey, some of the answers were not very clear, although it was a mandatory question, but we didn't get the clear answer. So, but we are very satisfied with the number of 87%. I will stop here. Mark will take over from here.
Yeah, I'm going to speak to the questions that really attempted to get at what the actual national and regional IGF events look like. And while there's much that is common among all of the initiatives that responded, the real beauty of the national and regional initiatives is that each take on a different flavor to reflect the unique needs and priorities of their host country or region. As Serena said, there's no one size fits all model, and the results of the survey certainly show that it's quite clear. They certainly tell the story, particularly from the structures of the events that are held, that each IGF, while is has a lot in common with its cousins around the globe, they're all unique and interesting in their own way. So when asked how the initiatives capture and document their initiative, the vast majority, 9 out of 10, responded that they use written reports by rapporteurs. Two-thirds had indicated that they also use a webcast to document and capture the initiative, and an additional two-thirds identified social media as a modality for capturing and documenting the event. Interestingly, only 30% of survey respondents indicated that they used transcripts to capture the event. As to what should I be doing this?
Yeah.
Multitasking might get difficult. As to what social media platforms were used, Facebook and Twitter were far and away the most commonly used among survey respondents, with just one respondent indicating that they used LinkedIn. And that's not necessarily surprising to those of us who are active in the social media world. For for streaming platforms used, again, not surprising, the most common streaming platform used was WebEx, like for obvious reasons. With statistically equal amounts of people using YouTube, proprietary website live streaming, and Adobe Connect, there were 6 non-respondents. I'm not taking that as a no that they don't live stream, but just a non-answer. This is the length of the event. I thought this was quite fascinating when we were going through the results. The vast majority of national and regional events are 1 or 2 days. Only one initiative indicated that their event is less than 1 day, and 5 had indicated that theirs is 3 days. On the higher end of the spectrum, the 2 day and the 3 day, generally those relate to events with much higher participation rates, and we'll get to numbers of attendees at the events, but keep in mind that the longer events generally have a higher participation than the shorter events. So about 3/4 of respondents indicated that they track the stakeholder group participating in their IGF. Another 2/3 track gender and youth participation in their IGF, and 39-40% track whether or not attendees have special needs or disability. And that's either through direct, well, for the most part, that's collected by having on the registration form the option to indicate whether or not an attendee will require special assistance when they attend the event. My surface is a little sticky right now. This is another interesting statistic. Number of participants in the annual event. The majority of them seem to have participation rates of between 100 and 250 individuals. 4 initiatives indicated that they were quite small, with 0 to 50 participants. It peters off a bit as we approach the 500 participant mark, but 3 initiatives did indicate that they have more than 500 participants at their events. And again, those appear to be the longer events. The larger events are also a lot more likely to hold multiple sessions, workshops, plenaries, and other types of sessions. As we talked about, well, for those that do collect the breakdown of their stakeholder group participants, there is a bit of a challenge because some stakeholder groups are named different things in different parts of the world. So we saw a challenge of academia and technical sector being lumped together by some initiatives, separated by others. So it was a little hard to do the analysis of this, but it does give you a pretty good idea of the balance of participant groups that attend national and regional IGFs. Certainly technical sector, government and private sector are pretty close to each other, as is civil society. Academia is a little lower, but that could be captured. That would increase likely if the difference in the way the titles for the stakeholder groups were collected, it might be a little higher. But it's interesting to see that for all of the initiatives, there is a reasonably good balance of stakeholder groups that participate. We had asked the initiatives how many sessions and types of sessions that they have at their event. the majority have between one and five plenary sessions or breakout sessions. 13, in fact, have between one and five plenary sessions. Six had between six and nine plenary sessions, with another five having between six and nine plenary sessions. When you get into the next figure, there are 10 plus, there are three that have more than 10 plenary sessions and more than two, more than 10 breakout sessions. Again, those are they correlate to the larger events with the greater participation, which is, you know, really a logical conclusion, but really shows the different flavor of the initiatives region to region, country to country. We asked them what types of sessions they have. 100% of survey respondents have an opening session, and 96% of very high percentage have plenary sessions, but only two-thirds have, only about two-thirds actually have breakout sessions, which is interesting. My IGF actually only has opening sessions and plenary sessions. We don't have breakout sessions, but when I was looking at the results from the survey, that we might look into it for our event next year. We'd asked what topics were discussed in workshops and events at the national and regional IGFs, and there were some challenges in analyzing the data because it was an open-ended question. So instead of presenting it as firm numbers, we're on the wrong slide. Instead of presenting it as firm numbers, we pulled together a word cloud, and you can see that the most common topics discussed at IGFs were internet governance, human rights and freedom of expression, critical internet resources and e-commerce, with security, Internet of Things, those things getting a lot less interest. Whether or not a regional or national IGF included the overarching theme or sub-themes from the IGF, three quarters had said yes, they do include the overarching themes or sub-themes from the IGF. And finally, in the event overview section, full 83% of initiatives have outcome or output statements or messages resulting from their event. With that, I think, Marilyn, you're going to do the engagement with the IGF piece.
Yes. So it's always been very interesting to me since I see so deep a linkage between the national and regional IGFs into the IGF, that there's been this continuing assertion that there's no linkage. And some of you in this room tell me this when you see me. And then I find that you have no time to come to a planning session about the national and regional IGFs because you're so busy doing a workshop or doing another event or doing an open forum about your event or speaking. And so I'm saying, I must be missing something. Because to me, the best example of the integration between the national and regional IGFs includes the human factor, and that is the duality of presence, people who are in multiple places. So we did ask the question because I was quite concerned that I keep hearing from people, there's no linkage. And I think one of the things that we need to learn more about is what do we want in terms of linkage? The other thing that has been going on since the CSTD working group improvements was published
has been this, in the last two meetings, there have been a lot of people going to the microphone and saying, well, the national and regional IGFs could do this work, and the national and regional IGFs could do that work. And the other thing that I worry about is, you know, I think, I'm the MAG chair also said this, I really question the ability of the national and regional IGFs to take work assignments as opposed to identifying things that are mutually beneficial. So to me, a good example of what was mutually beneficial was contributing to the Connecting the Next Billion, where on a dynamic basis and a voluntary basis, a good number of the national and regional IGFs voluntarily contributed and even did, we did a main plenary session. Access is not a topic at IGF USA that we can get more than 10 people in the room and talk about, because access is a very heavily, it's an issue that's dealt with very, very differently there. But when we did Connecting the Next Billion, we had a plenary session about it. So I'm thinking, what are we thinking about here in terms of calling for linkages? And I can't see that fly, so let me put my glasses on. So the engagement that we are, I am gonna look at that, sorry. The engagement questions that we ask you, we ask just basic questions, and that is, do you, whoever answered the questionnaire, do you actively follow the IGF planning and activities? Because I would have assumed the percentage would be low. In fact, 92% of the respondents said that they do actively follow the IGF planning and activities. The 64% of the respondents have MAG members in their region or country that are engaged in their initiative. Now, I actually was disappointed by this because since the job of the MAG member is to be actively engaged, not just in advising on planning the program, but to reflect backward into the community they come from, I think the fact that there's 36%, that's a pretty significant number, that for some reason they're not engaged in their national or regional initiative. And I think that's a question for us to ask. Okay, do MAG members understand that it doesn't mean you have to be on the steering group, but that you need to have some kind of reflection into your national or regional initiative so that there's cross-pollination of information? On engagement with the IGF, 60% of the respondents, remember this is the coordinators, attend the MAG meetings in person or virtually, which is pretty good. 72% in the past, have participated in the past substantive sessions, and we have had substantive sessions since 2009. So that was pretty good, I thought, and that we, you know, something that we should really continue to think about is how do we better publicize them and schedule them. And one idea might be that we would begin with our substantive session perhaps on day zero, when it wouldn't interfere so much with the rest of the program. On the intersessional activities, remember, participating in intersessional activities is not mandated, it is entirely voluntary. This question I was quite interested in because I was quite surprised about, but 78% of the initiatives have intersessional activities. 35% have contributed to the IGF's intersessional activities, which has been a huge amount of work for those of you who've taken it on. And 17% actually participate in the dynamic coalitions. 43% made a submission to the intersessional work on Connecting the Next Billion. So the idea that there is not a strong linkage between the national and regional IGFs, that's not borne out by what the questionnaire said. What may be borne out is the lack of visibility about the fact that the participant is also affiliated with a national or regional IGF. And I like Laura's idea of a pin or a flag that would sort of have a special designation so that people began to recognize you, that you're wearing dual hats. The IGF challenges, I think, are something for us to take on quite seriously as we look ahead for just the next few minutes. What you said was your greatest challenges, and I really expected you to say your greatest challenge was funding. Funding is a big challenge, but it was number three. Participation, inclusiveness, recruiting more participants and more diverse participants, and for some of the national and regional IGFs, the population you have to draw from is going to be very different, but you need at least three of the stakeholder groups. We're not required to have all five, but it's very true that in some countries, and I know we're talking Afghanistan, and I are talking about the idea of, you know, where will we find all five stakeholders, and will we be able to actually get all five initially? I think that's going to be true in some of the other African countries where we may get strong turnout from the technical community or the government and the civil society, but not strong turnout from business. But when we think about this, I think we need to go more granularly and think about this idea of what can we do to help. And I thought Anna's suggestion of some peer-to-peer exchanges where business who's actively engaged might do a better job of educating their fellow colleagues through industry associations, that there are other national initiatives and that they should get involved in them. So we also ask you if you're going to do an annual event in 2016, and there was actually a pretty significant, I thought, positive response. If you, 76% of you said yes, and the remainder said you don't know yet. So to me, that sounds pretty positive. It sounds like we're going to have a significant number of returning IGF national and regional initiatives. Let me open this very quickly for questions, and then I'm going to do a very quick summing up. I see two right here.
Thank you. Mary Uduma from Nigeria, NIGF. Some of the questions were not very, very clear when it came to one, especially the participation of the MAG members in the process, in the local national process. We found out that it was only in 2015 that we had a MAG member in our process. And it made a lot of difference because the MAG member was able to understand from global level what the thinking is and translating it to what we are trying to do at our local level. So that if it is for 2015, so before now, I think it was in Istanbul that I raised this, that we don't have MAG members in our process. We don't know who is our MAG member. So we are running our process, our initiative without the global MAG member. That's one of it didn't come out very good because we're just looking at 2015 in my own response. It was only 2015, but before now, it wasn't there. And for that reason, maybe by the time some of the questions are better refined, we'll be able to give precise response to it. Then the other one, we wanted to know why you want us to publish the budget. Is it for transparency? What we want to get at? Why did we ask about publishing the budget? We draw our budget, we get it, but we report it internally. We don't publish it on the website, on our website. It's not published on our website. So
let me answer that. How many of you in this room are the coordinator? How many of you have read your responsibilities on the website?
On whose website?
On the IGF website.
We didn't even know there was a responsibility because it was a voluntary thing that we started doing.
That's the reason I asked the question in that way. You actually do know because it says that you have to submit a report. But it says that you should operate in an open, transparent fashion. It doesn't dictate that you have to publish your budget. So that was we were asking the question in order to look at it from the standpoint of the CSTD report that's requiring improvements in the IGF. And it's sort of like you need to start publishing the gender breakdown as well. Now, you know, that's not saying that you have to have 50-50, although I think it's Zimbabwe that does, but you know, you have to start thinking about this as you're trying to be a reflection of the principles under which the IGF itself works. And so you're asked to operate in an open and transparent manner. Now you get to decide whether or not you publish the details of your budget. You were asked, do you have a budget? Then you were asked, do you publish it? Then you were asked, do you publish the source of the funding with amounts? It's not an effort to say that you have to do that, but it is an effort to sort of say, okay, if you're a new initiative and you want to look around and see best practices and you want to see what others are doing, who can you go to learn from? But I do think among the things that we need to be thinking about is what's the basic standard of practice that we as coordinators think should be mandatory in order to bear the seal. You are using the trademark of the IGF. You are listed on the IGF website. You have the halo effect of being listed on a website that is affiliated with the United Nations, right? So there's some criteria. And if you don't publish your report, some of you have not gotten your reports in from last year, in 2014, if you don't publish your report from 2014, what's the answer about when you should be removed from the website? The Secretariat's not going to make that rule. We're going to make that rule as the coordinators. You're going to have to make that decision. But you also have to ask yourself, you know, what kind of standards are we establishing so that there's a value to being a national and regional IGF? And I'm not trying, Mary, to impose them. The present standards come from the work of coordinators between 2007 and 2010 that collaborated on what those standards are. The Secretariat did not require the publication of an annual report. We voluntarily established that. I think Mark Carvel insisted on it, as a matter of fact. That was a joke. But so that was the reason, and I took a long time to answer it. But I think you guys need to look at this and say, what do you think the standard of practice ought to be? Not today, but when we come back together, what do you think the standard of practice ought to be? I'm going to give you a for instance. Some initiatives have a single source of funding. There's nothing wrong with that, as long as they operate in an open and transparent fashion. But I think what we're trying to accomplish is creating a standard of practice and a learning, not to say one size fits all. I have some ideas that I'm going to work with the staff and the other co-moderators about. I want to flesh out this idea about the observatory. I want to think about the brand recognition. I want to go back and talk about the possibility of doing the Meet the National and Regional IGF publication quickly, you know, and come back to all of you. But I think the other thing is we're going to take this list and start a new email list and work on the follow-up to this particular session as a subgroup. And then we'll figure out how to take it out to the broader group of the coordinators. But I need to turn this over to the Secretariat.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Can I just say a couple of words before we close up? When Marilyn said to me that we're going to have a session here that will be longer than 3 hours, I was very skeptic, and I was thinking that we're going to have empty chairs after 1 hour. Thank you very much on behalf of the IGF Secretariat. What I can tell you, I've been communicating with the majority of you during the last 3 months, and what I can tell you is that for the IGF Secretariat, you are the most important outcome, but also income. Because thanks to you, we that are sitting in our offices and typing all the time on our computers know what are happening on the field. We know the numbers, we know what are your challenges, and thank you very much for this. I don't have a lot of criticism for any of your initiatives, although you are a bit late with the reports. So please send us your reports. You know all the criteria. We have some great reports received. Now, last thing, and you're off. I want to thank Marilyn Cade for the coordination, for the work with the IGF Secretariat, for huge help. I have no idea that people exist like you. I don't know how you did this, but thank you very much. You are helping so much, and I'm sure I'm speaking to behalf of all of you. Marilyn, would you like to say the magical word that they can leave her?
The magical word is next door is the annual meeting of the IGF Support Association. And I would love it if all of you would come, whether you are a member of the Support Association or not at this time. It is a resource to you because it is the source of the small grants that we are fundraising to be able to provide to the national and regional IGFs. So do come. Even if you're not a member. We're not serving you food, but we'll try to keep the meeting short. It's in room 7.
Saeed, I had a couple observations that I didn't get a chance earlier. It's just that for countries who are developing new national IGFs, countries who in transparency index rank very high, the transparency in the process of multi-stakeholder should be, I think, provided. And I think the dominance of the governments as the key stakeholder in those countries should be, there should be some sort of a condition. That these countries, because they list so high in the transparency index because of some corruption or some other incompetency attributes, there should be some conditions on their government's role in the multi-stakeholder process. And someone commented the fact that bottom-up, the IGF is a bottom-up approach, so you know it's up to the countries how they manage it. But then again, I'm saying I come from a country where democracy is just a label, but operationally in organization and in governments, we are very authoritarian. In individual authoritarianism and process authoritarianism is there. So the bottom-up approach is not a very successful thing for us to practice. A couple suggestions, if I could add, is if we could bring the dynamic coalition or the best practice forum to the regional level, because there will be some areas like access could be something that could be specific to a region or some political, economical, similar countries. And also the awareness could be an issue in some region and not in the other, just like you said, in the United States. The content development and management, that could be another theme for some of the regional IGFs. That's it. Thank you very much.
More important announcement.
Yes, just a short announcement. Tomorrow, starting at 11, room 4, I am organizing a workshop, which is called IGF Initiatives MasterChef. So it is for all of us, national and regional IGF participants, coordinators, panelists, and please welcome to this workshop. We're going to have some interesting discussions and set out recommendations for preparing for organizing IGFs on national and regional levels. You're all welcome there. Tomorrow, room 4, starting at 11. Thank you.
Thank you all. We'll see you in the room next door.